This is a Fox Sports presentation.
We're on the bus outside the Pontiac Silverdome getting ready to broadcast the traditional Thanksgiving Day game between the Lions and the Bears this year. And John, as you think about all the people around the country sitting down to enjoy Thanksgiving with their friends and their families, we're here with our friends and our family, and we indeed have a lot to be thankful for.
Well, I think 17 years together, 17 great years, and to me there's nothing better. There's no place that I would rather be today on Thanksgiving than right here, right now at a football game. And there's just certain things that go together, you know, the turkey, the family, the tradition, football, and we have it all today. And we have the whole tradition of the National Football League. You know, I carry a picture of Red Grange around, and I look at this and I think the first Thanksgiving Day game ever played was here in Detroit, the Chicago Bears at Detroit, and Red Grange was in that game. And I think when you have that, when you have Red Grange and you have turkey and stuffing and dumplings and football and the Chicago Bears and the Detroit Lions, I don't think it gets any better than this.
Well, there's one other great thing that we, both of us, have to be thankful for, and that is we're both in good health. I look forward to another 17 great years. Right now, we're going to head inside to the booth to get ready to broadcast today's game. And today, as you watch the contest, you'll get a chance to see arguably one of the best runners ever to play pro football, Barry Sanders. So while we head inside, you get ready to watch Barry at his best.
Hand off, this is Sanders. Look out.
He gets the ball. He's making moves on moves.
When God created Barry Sanders, even he didn't know what he made.
Countdown continues.
The Pontiac Silverdome, Thanksgiving Day, the Chicago Bears against the Lions. The Lions in a must-win. This is moments ago, the coin flip. The honorary captain today is the Detroit police officer. There he is right there, Octavius Miles. He heard a story of, or on his police radio, as a matter of fact, he heard that a car had been stolen, was traveling at high speed through downtown Detroit. He happened to be in the area, drove his car to the scene, and saw that some school children who had just gotten out of school were in danger of being run over by the stolen car. He drove his car into the path of the stolen vehicle and thereby saved a bunch of school children from what could have been very tragic. And you have to today particularly, although always, be particularly thankful for a man who would do that act, that heroic act, Octavius Miles. The Bears will receive Chicago's 8-5 against Detroit on Thanksgiving Day. This is a must-win for the Lions to keep playoff hopes alive. Fabian Bowen back. Doesn't make it back to the 20, and let's look at the Bears' offense. Led by 1991 Turkey Leg Award winner Eric Kramer, formerly player here in Detroit, Andy Heck, Perry, Valerio, Todd Berger, and James Williams, the offensive line. Raymond Harris, Tony Carter, Ricky Prohl, Curtis Conway, and John Allred, the rookie tight end, gets the start. Conway and Prohl come left. Eric Kramer on first and 10 from the 18. Raymond Harris, nothing doing. Mike Wells made the stop. this Detroit defensive unit, and that's the front four, Scroggins, Ellis, Wells, and Porche. The linebackers, Brown, Boyd, and Jamison. The secondary, two rookies at the cornerbacks, Brian Westbrook and Kevin Abrams, Carrier and Rice, the two safeties. Second and nine. Kramer back to throw it. To the green spot. Tony Carter was the nearest pair.
I'll tell you, if the Bears are going to do anything today, Pat, they're going to have to get that middle block, especially Luther Ellis. If you want to see, these are the two guys that really raise heck. But watch Luther Ellis here. He's the guy that's going to get the pressure on Kramer. See, he just gets a push right up in the middle. He just pushes Todd Berger right into Eric Kramer. On the play before that, he was the guy that stuffed Raymond Harris when he tried to run in the middle.
Third down. That's their conversion rate. Not among the best. Kramer. Again to the same green spot.
Yep, and again by Luther Ellis. Luther Ellis this time lined up on the other side. He's against Todd Perry. The time before he beat Berger. This time he beats Perry. Watch him. He's right here. And you're just going to see he just takes Perry, just gives him a push. And watch, he's going to show up. Boom! Right there as Eric Kramer's throwing the ball.
Pretty impressive start for the Detroit defense. Glenn Milburn back deep. Sauerbrunn back to punt. Milburn retreats. It's a good punt back to the 20. Nothing doing there. Mangum down to make the stop. Let's look at the Detroit offense, led by 6'6" Scott Mitchell. 16-9 at home. The front: Roberts, Compton, Glover, Jeff Hardings, and Juan Roque. Sanders and Vardell, the two backs. Johnny Morton, Herman Moore, the wide receivers, and David Sloan.
Well, that Juan Roque is a big guy, isn't he? The right tackle, rookie right tackle.
Is he ever? 6'6", 330. Mitchell. Just shy of the 45. Let's look at the Bear defense. The tackle made by Mangum. Reeves, Simpson, Flanagan, and Mark Thomas. The Bear front. Their linebackers, Minter, Cox, and Cox. Brian Cox in the middle. Ron Cox, the other backer. The secondary, Harris and Carter, the corners. Mangum and Marty Carter, the safeties. First Marty, and 10.
Marty Carter was a little slow getting up after that first down play, Pat.
Barry Sanders. Taken down by Mark Thomas. No gain, maybe a loss.
Yeah, we talk about the greatness of Barry Sanders. Well, I'll tell you, he's a marked guy. I mean, if you're going to key anything on any running down, the guy that everyone is going to look at is number 20. And you know that you have to pursue, you have to have gang tackling. And what the Bears are going to try and do today is the first guy there take an aggressive shot at him, an aggressive shot at his outside.
Sanders behind the line momentarily. Squirted through for a couple.
Seeing the first guy up.
Whoop.
A melee's breaking out.
On Thanksgiving Day.
A melee on Thanksgiving Day. What would Red Grange think? But the first guy in there that made an aggressive move was Brian Cox. He gets penetration. He's going to be the first guy there, and he makes Barry Sanders change his area.
And then rakes the ball out.
Watch Brian Cox. He's going to come straight up the middle. You're going to see him right here. He raises a havoc there. He's the first guy. He took an aggressive shot. He didn't get him. But he made him misdirect, change directions, and then the other Bear defenders could get there.
Third and 12. They just do get it off. That's Johnny Morton, doesn't get the first down. Just shy by about a yard. Michael Lowry wrestled him to the ground.
Well, the fans here want Bobby Ross to go for it on this Thanksgiving Day, but Bobby Ross says, nope, we're just getting started here, and we got some pretty good protection going. We'll get our running going later, because he said that's one thing that he's learned with Barry Sanders is you have to have patience with the run.
John Jett. Punt sails down to Tyrone Hughes. Fair catch. And the Bears will take over for the second time. Neither team can move it. Nothing, nothing.
This Fox NFL special is brought to you by Southwest Airlines, proud sponsor of the NFL and official airline of the Super Bowl. By Ford and your Ford dealer. Have you driven a Ford lately? And by For Richer or Poorer from Universal Pictures, starring Tim Allen and Kirstie Alley. Starts Friday, December 12th, rated PG-13.
Thanksgiving Day, and happy Thanksgiving to all of you from all of us. Detroit nothing, Chicago nothing. 11:19 left to play in the first quarter from the Pontiac Silverdome.
Yeah, there's the guy that the Bears are going to have to start blocking if they're going to have any success. Number 94, Luther Ellis.
They haven't done it yet. Allred is the move man. Kramer back to throw it. Wheels it up to Chris Penn. And that should be enough for a Bear first.
You know, that's one thing I think that they're going to have to do with this defense is mix it up and not always run on first down right. And run on second down and then get in third and long and have to pass. The Bears are not that kind of team. They're not good enough to play that kind of football. They're going to have to mix up and throw a lot more on first down as they did then.
On first down is Raymond Harris. I beg your pardon. It's Tony Carter, the fullback, who gets the carry.
Yeah, they just aren't going to make anything inside. You know, we were talking before the game that they were thinking they were going to have to go outside. But watch Ellis here. I mean, you're just not going to get anything on he or Wells. I mean, those two guys are playing dominant in the middle. And I think that, you know, maybe you should tire them out a little or do something like that. Go to the outside, pass more on first down, but you're not going to get anything running there.
Here's Raymond Harris. Good pursuit. And again, those two guys in the middle get out and become a part of it. Stephen Boyd led the defensive charge.
Well, again, Luther Ellis gets that penetration inside, so there's no cutback, and then that means that you have to string it out to the sideline, and then those linebackers in the secondary can come out there in pursuit. But so far, we're just starting this game, I know, but so far, Luther Ellis is dominating that offensive line of the Bears wherever he goes, and he goes right side and left side.
Third and six. And you're right. Wherever he plays, he has dominated. Who's across from him? Kramer. Back to throw it. Here comes the blitz. He just does get rid of it, but does, and this is Ricky Prohl. To the 15-14 and knocked out of bounds. They read the blitz and took advantage of it. Carrier knocked him out of bounds.
I think if Eric Kramer feels real good about any receiver, it's Ricky Prohl. But watch the blitz. They have a free man coming straight up the middle. Now you talk about a tough guy. Eric Kramer has to stand in there. Robert Porche was not blocked. He was coming straight at him. Eric Kramer just stood right in there and threw that ball to Ricky Prohl. Watch. Here comes Porche straight up the middle. Now, Eric Kramer knows that he is going to get that hit. But look at that concentration. You know that guy's there. You
yep.
feel that guy's there. But you still step into that pass.
They got 53 yards. This is Raymond Harris, who dives across the 10 to about the 8. Not much nonsense about Raymond Harris.
You know,
straight ahead runner.
Of all the Bears, to me, he's the most impressive player. And if
yep.
you think of, you know, who off of this team, if you were going to build a team or start a team or coach a team, who would you want? I think that it's probably that guy right there, Raymond Harris, that I would take.
Not a lot of fancy running, but a lot of straight ahead ground gaining. Just like that.
Well, and he does just like that. I mean, he hits the hole quickly. He's a slasher, but even more important than that, watch how he finishes a runoff. I mean, he's going to start right here, and he's going to come straight up the middle, and watch how quickly he'll get to the hole. Right there. It's a little counter move. Quick to the hole, right through. And then watch right there at the end. Boom. He unloads
yep.
on the tackler. Instead of the tackler hitting him and knocking back, he takes the blue jersey and knocks him backwards.
Yesterday, when we talked to him, he was so sore and so beat up, he couldn't even shake hands.
He says his whole right side of his body.
The This is Raymond Harris. He's in the end zone. Touchdown Bear. The 53-yard gain from Kramer to Prohl is what set it up.
And Eric Kramer, brave in that pocket. Yep. I'll tell you, being able to stand in there against the blitz, and that's what you get with a blitz. You're going to get some big plays defensively. The Bears got a big play offensively against the Lions.
Jeff Jaeger for the extra point. Raymond Harris got the touchdown, but the key was Kramer's read of that blitz and the pass completion to Prohl. 7-0, the Bears lead in this traditional Thanksgiving Day game. That's a pretty good message. I can just give thanks that we can give thanks.
That's not bad, and
no?
Eat a big fat turkey. Thankful you can give thanks. And
do you want your turkey too? You don't want your turkey too fat, though.
Well, yeah, I mean, you don't want one of those that have been running around. You know, you don't want an aerobic turkey.
A free-range?
No, you don't want one of those. They don't have any meat in their bones. You need something with big old meat in those big old legs.
Probably have a point. That's Melbourne. His tackle just outside the 20.
You know, one of the things that the Bear defense is going to do is they're going to take Walt Harris and they're going to flip him either side. He's going to go with Herman Moore. And it's kind of surprising. You know, you would think that maybe a Tom Carter would do that. But Walt Harris has really been probably one of the most improved guys on this Bear defense. And Dave Wannstedt has a heck of a lot of confidence in him. And I think when you put him on Herman Moore, you're showing that you have a lot of confidence in him.
Because Herman Moore is one of the best and biggest of the wide receivers. This is Barry Sanders. And right now for McDonald's game break, let's return to James Brown at the Fox Television Center at Hollywood.
All right, Pat, in the annals of outstanding Thanksgiving Day games, Barry Sanders on a long run here against Minnesota has the ball stripped. Did he make up for it? You bet he did. Next series, 50 yards to pay dirt, had 138 yards in Detroit's 44-38 win over Minnesota. Back to Pat Summerall and John Madden.
You just have to be patient. Bobby Ross said that's one of the things he had to learn. Mitchell looks and throws to Moore. He can't stay in bounds. If he could have, he was gone.
Yeah, heck of a play by Herman Moore and Mitchell also, because Walt Harris is really on him. Now watch, Walt Harris is going to be here. He's on Herman Moore. He's going to kind of run and out here. Walt Harris has that covered, and then Herman Moore makes an adjustment. Watch it here. You see, Harris has help in behind him, so he's going to jump that short out. And then when Herman Moore feels that, he takes that short out, and he just finds that hole between Walt Harris and the safety.
Yeah, that's a good throw by Mitchell.
That was a heck of an adjustment by Herman Moore. You're right, a good throw by Mitchell.
Mitchell with Carl Reeves all over him. Ball's down.
You know, remember what Bobby Ross was telling us yesterday, that Mitchell seems to get in more trouble when he runs to his left.
Yep.
He said he hates to see him run to his left because that's when bad things happen to him, and that's when he usually throws his interceptions. Now, you would think, you know, like Steve Young, a left-hander, he was very successful when he goes to his left.
You think this is intentional grounding? Walt Coleman, the referee.
All the officials had dinner with us last
intentional
night.
Intentional grounding on the offense, number 19. Loss of down, second down.
You see, now it wouldn't be intentional grounding if he got all the way outside where the tight end would normally line up, mm-hmm. because then he's not in the backup. But here, you see, now he would have to get outside this area right here. Now, if he's in the drop back area, which he's in right there, and he throws the ball away, that's intentional grounding. Had he got about 2 or 3 yards wider, he could have legally done that.
Nobody in the area. Mitchell has some time. This time gets it to Sloan. And Sloan bangs away outside the 40. Up to about the 43-yard line. They pick up what they lost, but still 10 shy of the first.
You notice how everyone is going for the strip today. You know, remember Lawrence Taylor started years ago. And what happened is a lot of times when you go for the strip like Brian Cox does here and you don't get the strip, you also do what? You miss the tackle.
Which Brian Cox just did. Third and 11.
He's probably thinking that he's going to have another guy right there to make the tackle.
Three wide receivers this time. Two of them to the left. Here's Mitchell. Screen pass coming, and the Bears played it very well. From Sanders.
You know, that's one thing I've noticed about defensive linemen now. They're playing the screens very well all the time.
That's Flanagan.
Yeah, that time it was Flanagan and Simpson. They both came off well. You know, they start to rush, and when they feel the guards let them go, then they stop rushing towards the quarterback and just turn and go to the screen guy.
Jet back to butt. Good kick. Hughes retreats to about the 11. Gets it to the 21. Kowalski down to make the stop. 7-0, the Bears lead with 5 left in the first quarter. Back at the Pontiac Silverdome, the Bears 7, Detroit nothing. The annual Thanksgiving Day game. Been going on since 1934.
And the in that first game, it was the Bears here against Detroit. And you know who the MVP of the game was? Bronco Nagurski.
Remember what a great football name that is and what a player he was.
Oh, look at this one.
Wide open is Ricky Prohl to the 30. To the 10. Ricky Prohl, touchdown Bears. How did he get so open?
Well, it was a double zone. The corner let him go. You know, we talked about rookie corners. Kevin Abrams is a rookie corner on this side. Here's Abrams here. The safety is going to come over here, but you're going to see neither one of these guys do a job. Here's Ricky Prohl right here. Now let's look at him from this angle here. Here's Prohl. There's Kevin Abrams, you see, and he doesn't get a good bump, and then he pulls off too quickly. He just lets him go, and the safety doesn't get over. It's a poor job by the corner and a poor job by the safety not getting over. It was Ron Rice.
Jaeger's extra point is good, and the Bears lead 14-0.
How about
this for two catches? Wow.
It was Ricky Prohl. Woo, what a day.
He's supposed to be a possession receiver.
This Fox NFL special is brought to you by Lexus and the new faster, sleeker, meaner GS.
The Bears 14, Detroit nothing, 4:45 left in the first. Who would have thought?
Who would have thought that Ricky Prohl would catch the longest pass of his career?
This is Glenn Milburn at about the 6. Out of the pack is Milburn. Milburn to the 40, still on his feet. And returns to the Bear 24-yard line. Bowens finally knocked him out of bounds.
Well, the Detroit Lions needed a wake-up call. They needed a wake-up call for their team, their coaches, their fans, everyone. Watch this. You see, here's the wedge. The wedge is going to go wedge right. You see, so he gets right into the wedge, and then he breaks through the wedge. Now there's only one guy, the kicker. He makes a move on the kicker there, and then makes a cutback. You always cut back against the kicker. You never let a kicker run you out of bounds.
69-yard return by Milburn.
Yeah, you make someone else run you out of bounds, not the guy who kicked the ball.
Mitchell back to throw on first down. Incomplete, intended for Morton. Good play by Tom Carter.
That was a heck of a play by Tom Carter. That's a tough pattern to throw when you're throwing a hook pattern against tight coverage. Watch it. See, here you got tight coverage. Now, Johnny Morton is just going to run up and stop and hook back towards the quarterback. That is a tough pass to throw against a tight corner. Watch Tom Carter get around there, not interfere, and get that hand in there and knock the ball down.
Barry Sanders. Hit down at about the 22 by Marty Carter.
Barry Sanders, you know that it's just a matter of time. And, you know, we were talking about whatever you do, Barry Sanders has to carry the ball about 25 times per game. I mean, he's had four. I mean, this is an ugly-looking thing here where you have four rushes and 3 yards. But Bobby Ross knows that you still have to stay with it because at some point he is going to break some.
Third and eight. The Bears do not blitz. Pass is incomplete. Mitchell for Morton.
Johnny Morton better watch out.
He picked up a marker on the sideline and fired it down. And the Bears are down in a hurry, screaming that should be a penalty.
Well, they're having trouble with this tight coverage here. See, the Bear corners are up tight on the receivers. And they're having problems with it. They're having problems getting away from it. I don't think they're running the right patterns. I know that it's hard to run short outs and it's hard to run hooks against tight coverage.
That was not a very good pattern.
And the other one on the other side by Johnny Morton wasn't a good pattern.
From 40 yards out, Hanson will try to put the Lions on the board. And he does. 14-3 is the score. The Bears lead. Prime Star Skate International Series this weekend begins a weekend of championship skating on Fox's Olympic hopefuls take to the ice. Catch the world champion Tara Lipinski and some of the world's best skaters as they compete in the Prime Star Skate International Champion Series. Coverage begins tomorrow at 8 Eastern and Pacific on Fox.
Dave Wannstedt has to feel pretty good about the start of this game. He doesn't have a lot to feel good about all year. I mean, he's only won 2 games and really been a frustrating and disappointing season for Dave Wannstedt, and he's taken a heck of a lot of criticism, but the way his team has started out playing today, that is a positive thought. I know, and you know, Bobby Ross, I know what he's talking about. He's talking to his receivers because he said one of the things he challenged his receivers yesterday to have to beat the press of the Chicago Bear corners, and to be honest, they haven't done it yet.
No, they haven't.
That's been their problem.
Herman Moore has the one catch. The others have gone to Morton, and he hasn't been able to shake the corners.
You know, you think of a game, you know, starts here at 12:30 in Detroit. What time does a guy have to get up to start putting that stuff on him for a 12:30 game?
He gets up with the turkeys. Good coverage.
The turkeys, we got them days ago. The turkeys, they've had their day, and they're done. They're in ovens now.
Well, you got a turducken. How long does that take? 3 times as long?
Yeah, you have to do that. How many legs are on the turkey? Well, you know what happens is we have our basic four on the turkey, you know, the normal 4 legs, and then with the El Nino thing, we don't have as many this year. We have 2 more.
Yeah.
So they have, it's kind of 6 leg. Then we have a turducken, which is a duck stuffed in a chicken stuffed in a turkey.
And that's what El Nino caused.
El Nino knocked a couple legs off coming over the Continental Divide.
Yeah. And El Nino blew the turkeys and the duck together, right?
Well, that's the thing. And then deboned them, too.
Yeah. You never know about the El Nino.
Well, it's coming up from the south, and then what happened is the turkeys were coming down from the north, and that's what in the Continental Divide.
That'll put things together. Here's Kramer, spreading right.
Holy moly,
throws to Ryan Wetnight. Yes, I did.
That must have hit one of our parabs down there.
That's the noise of the game.
Old Eric Kramer told Wetnight just run up the field and run out at the parab. That's a parab right there. Wait, what's the real word for it? Parable or something? Parabolic. I knew it was one of those words. Parable.
Let's stick with parab.
No, parable something else. Parabolic.
Eric Kramer, 4 out of 6. The one touchdown to Ricky Prohl. Another long gainer to Prohl. Set up the other. Kramer back to throw. Up the middle. caught by Ryan Wetnight, and that's a Bear first down.
I tell you, you know, one of the things that we talked about is getting control of this line, and this Chicago Bear offensive line has gotten control. They had a problem on the first series, but since then, they've gotten control on the run blocking, and they've also gotten a heck of a lot of control with pass protection because Eric Kramer has been able to make some big throws against this Detroit defense. And that feels pretty good. When you're a quarterback and you're looking out there at two rookie corners, that's kind of fun.
First and 10, Carter on the move. This is Raymond Harris for a couple. Ricky Prohl on the blitz. They read it.
Yep, that was a hot read, and he was just running a slant. Kramer stood in there. Robert Porcher was about to hit him. Here, I think Abrams is wrong. That's a rookie cornerback. He just let the guy go too soon. Rice, the strong safety, didn't get over there. But Kramer seeing him was a big play.
Second and 9. Flag on the play. As Carter's hit right at the line of scrimmage. The Lions might have been early.
Well, I know one guy was early. I know Robert Porcher was early. I mean, he was about 5 steps in the backfield before the ball was ever snapped.
Walt Coleman, the referee.
Offside on the defense, number 91, 5-yard penalty. Repeat second down.
There's Robert Porcher. Watch him. Now again, he has to be out there and look in and see the ball. I mean, he got so offside, so far offside, he had to stop and slow up.
Second and 4. Two tight ends set up this time. That's Wetnight on the move. Fake is to Raymond Harris, and Kramer's coming out of there. Close to first down yardage, tripped up by Luther Ellis.
You know, one of the things that Dave Wanstead was saying, and Eric Kramer was saying the same thing, that we have to be able to throw the ball. We have to get them out of those presses. We have to get them out of those 8-man fronts. But not only throw those little 3- and 4- and 5-yard passes, we have to get the ball up the field. And that's what they've done in this first quarter.
Kramer got enough.
I mean, Kramer ran that one, but he's now 5 out of 7 for 165 yards. And he's thrown 3 passes so far for over 20 yards. Now, that's a big difference in this Bear offense today. I mean, they've completed passes. Raymond Harris has run this year, but they haven't had those 20-plus yard passes.
Clock ticking down to signify the end of the first quarter. Eric Kramer looks very confident.
And I'll tell you, he has sure quieted the sellout crowd down, hasn't he?
Ever. At the end of 1, the Bears lead the Lions 14-3. If I see a flying emu, I'm leaving the area.
I've been looking for an emu for a long time. I've always thought if you ever do get an emu, you just bake it. And
hey, Madden, you bring enough bird for everybody?
Yeah, I got enough bird. I got bird, I got turducken, and now I got some emu, and we're baking the emu in the oven on the bus right now as we speak.
The oven's not that big.
For emu?
Raymond Harris. 4 about 8.
How's this for a first quarter for the Chicago Bears? I mean, they have, look at that, total yards, 190 total yards in the first quarter. 7 first downs. I mean, they've really had their way. I mean, they started out, and it looked like the Detroit defense was going to dominate that defensive line, and then the Bears and Eric Kramer just took over, and since that point, they've had their way with these guys.
Darnell Autry is the deep back. And the reverse comes to Conway. Conway gets around the corner and steps out about a 1/2 yard shy of a first down.
You know, that's one of the guys that the Bears have missed big time is Curtis Conway, because one of their problems is they don't have a lot of speed on offense. And Curtis Conway is their only speed. And then He's only played really three games for him this year. And when he's out of there, then everyone can bunch up, you know, on the run. And at the same time as you're bunching up on the run, you're bunching up on the short passing, and you have no one to get deep.
Third and short. Autry.
I don't know about that. He went sideways.
Yep. The Lions are saying, we got the ball.
Well, it was third down. It wasn't fourth down.
Right.
So they don't get the ball unless there was a fumble.
That's what I was thinking.
The ball is at the 35-yard line. You know, if it's not a first down, what do you do? Do you go for it, or do you kick a field goal? It would be a 52-yard field goal attempt from here.
I think if you're Dave Wannstedt and the Bears, the kind of year they've had, they go for it, if it's not a first down.
One of the reasons that they mark it when you know that it's short is a coach can ask for a marking just to see how far you have to go for the first down. And that's what Dave Wannstedt just asked for there, to get the marking so he knows exactly how much he needs for the first down. And as you say, Pat, he's going to go for it on fourth down.
So far, the Bears don't look like a team with all kind of problems and a 2-10 record.
I don't think I'd run Autry again on it, though.
I don't think so. That's Raymond Harris. They tried Kramer.
And he went sideways, too.
I'm not sure. There comes the ball.
If they give him the initial spot, he didn't make it. And then at the end, you know, at the fight, he could have made it. Dave Wannstedt's fighting for it over there. Doesn't make any difference what he says.
No.
There's two Bear coaches out on the field.
That looks like he made it, because it got up to that yard line marker.
If he makes it, though, it's going to be by just a chain length or two. It's right in the middle of the line, and the marker was right in the middle of the line.
Right.
Ooh. Ooh, and it's short by a length. Or over by a length.
Over by a length.
Let's see where they stop him here. We'll just look at it on the clicker. And you see, it's where the ball is, where they stop. Now he doesn't have it. But he keeps fighting right there. He's not down, and it's where it is now when his knee goes down, where the ball is. You see, it's not where his knee is when he goes down, but it's where the football is when his knee goes down. Eric Kramer got that first down by just stretching the football out there at the end.
In the beginning, took sort of a half a step backwards.
One of the things you always worry about when you put it out there like that is getting knocked out of there.
Pass is deflected, intended for Raymond Harris. Bounced over his head.
I think they've had so much success with their wide receivers and that, you know, stuff he was throwing to Ricky Prohl and Wet Knight as tight end. I think maybe I'd kind of go back to that in this area.
Look at the total yards. 200 to 58. Barry Sanders has 3 yards.
Yeah, and this is the way to slow down Barry Sanders, is to keep him over in the sideline by keeping your offense out there and start winning the time of possession battle.
They've been out there a while. Here comes the trap play. That's Raymond Harris. Only got a couple. Drives of 10 plus plays, most in the NFL.
Yeah, I mean that hasn't been their problem. I mean,
no.
Their problem has been scoring touchdowns and, you know, and stopping people.
12th play of this drive coming up. Dave Wannstedt.
He is in every play. I mean, Dave Wannstedt is, you know, wants his team to do well, wants himself to do well, wants this for the Chicago, you know, Bears. For, I mean, everyone, and he's really put his whole life into this.
He really has. Harris.
I don't know about those calls, though. I mean, I don't know, you know, they had so much success throwing the ball, as I said, to their outside receivers, and they have two rookie corners out there and to their tight end, and then they run Raymond Harris in there. They don't get anything. Then they come back with a draw on third and long. I'm not sure about that. I don't know. When you have things going, keep doing it until they stop you.
51 yards out, the field goal attempt coming up.
Look at this stance, Pat.
Jager. That's hooking in there. And good from 51, 17-3. Dave Wonsett's Chicago Bears increase their lead.
This Fox NFL special is brought to you by Southwest Airlines, proud sponsor of the NFL and official airline of the Super Bowl. By Honda, vehicles designed to help simplify your life. And by Visa, the official card of the NFL. It's everywhere you want to be.
Motown Studios. A lot of music come out of there. Hitsville. Could apply to music. Could apply to football.
That's what you see on this thing. When you get a kickoff cover team going down against a kickoff return, you're going to see a lot of Hitsville.
At the five is Milbourne.
Right there.
Again, he's got some room. Again, he cuts back against the kicker. And again, he gets across midfield.
Again, we talked about Hitsville, and that was a wedge. And you see what Glenn Milbourne does is he gets right in behind the wedge. You see, here's the wedge right here. These four guys, they're going to form the wedge. Now watch as they start to the outside. You see, they come together right there. Then that's a wedge. Boom, there's your Hitsville right there. Milbourne takes it up into the wedge, lets all those guys do their hitting, and then he bounces it to the outside and just runs right around it.
You see what happened to the kicker, Sauerbrunn?
What?
After the parade went by, somebody hit him in the back.
After the parade went by?
Yeah.
You know, Bobby Ross has five things that he always figures that you have to do to win a game, and field position is one of them. And, you know, he's doing well in that area, not doing well in the others. Turnover, third down, field position, red zone, and penalties. Those are his five things.
Mitchell. Incomplete. Intended for Morton.
Yeah, Bobby Ross was telling us that these are the categories that he says to win games, you have to win these things. The turnover ratio, third down conversions, starting field position, you know, and that's the one he is winning, red zone offense, and penalties. And he says every time, he said most of the time when they win four out of those, they usually win the game. He said when they win five of those things, they always win wherever he's been.
Bears coming on a blitz. Mitchell, Reddick, pass is dropped, incomplete. Sloan, the tight end, had the first down. Couldn't hang on.
Yeah, that's the thing that the Lions are doing. They're getting some plays, they're getting some guys open, but they're you know dropping the ball, they're getting a penalty. They just can't keep drives going.
Jet. High, good kick again. They signal fair catch. The ball bounds toward the end zone. And the Lions will down it at the one. What a kick by John Jett. Ron Rivers down to down it. And so the Bears will go to work from their own one-yard line. Our turkey leg award has been going on since 1989. Reggie White was the first winner.
Now, Reggie White, you notice something different about that uniform. That's not a Green Bay Packer uniform.
That's a Philadelphia Eagle.
It was when Reggie White was a dominant defensive end for the Philadelphia Eagles. Reggie White, one of the best that's ever played.
Did we give him the turkey or he took it?
No, just one leg. We gave it to him.
Eric Kramer with problems.
Yeah, watch Reggie Brown. He's gonna come from this top side right here. He's not blocked, and he just runs right in there. And you see Eric Kramer is turning to his left, and again, there's Reggie Brown who's not blocked.
No.
He just comes straight in there, so Eric Kramer is gonna have to throw it over him or around him or through him, and it doesn't work.
Carter on the move. Raymond Harris gets the carry, and he's hit. Very near the goal line.
This is going to be very close to a safety. He has to get that ball out across the line the same way you have to get it in across the line.
Spindler made the stop.
This is a very dangerous area because, you know, if you don't get it out, it's a 2 points, it's a safety. Or if you throw the ball and you have a penalty in the end zone, say you have offensive holding in the end zone, that is also a safety.
Third and 10, Darnell Autry replaced Raymond Harris.
But it didn't look like Raymond Harris got the ball out that far, did it?
No, it sure didn't. Autry is the deep back. Helmet comes out. Autry goes down.
No head in the helmet.
No head in the helmet.
That's always good news. But the thing is, now the punter normally stands back 15 yards from the center. So if you don't get the ball out to the 5-yard line, then your punter doesn't have his normal 15-yard drop. And this is a good time to come in a block because the punter is 2 yards closer to the center than he normally is, and he has to worry about this back line here. Because if he steps on that, that's a safety.
Todd Sauerbrunn back there. And the Lions do not try to block it, and this is a rocket ship of a kick. As it goes about 75, 80 yards in the air, Milburn again. And again, the Lions have good field position. That's Autry, the previous play. Watch the helmet come out of there. Do you stop playing because you lost your helmet?
Not if you're a middle linebacker. You're Stephen Boyd. You just keep on tackling.
Happy Thanksgiving.
That's from our man, Bob Mueller. Mike Roig. Thank you, Mike. Thank you, Bob. And a happy Thanksgiving to everyone. Todd Sauerbrunn has punted twice, averaging 65 yards. His last one traveled in the air 80 yards.
Now that is a boomer, huh?
Yeah. Herman Moore is a move man. Pass is complete to Morton. And for a McDonald's game break, let's return to James Brown at the Fox Television Center in Hollywood.
Hey, Pat, if Chicago keeps playing the way they are, they won't need this. You recall this, Dave Williams, Thanksgiving Day, 1980. Opening kickoff in overtime, 95 yards to pay dirt. First player ever to return a kickoff for a TD in overtime. And that Bears victory. Back to Pat and John.
Yes, I remember that game. This is Pat Sanders.
Well, you know, it was just a matter of time. Up until that play, Barry Sanders had had 5 carries and only gained 2 yards. And that's the patience we talk about. That when you have Barry Sanders, you just keep feeding him the ball. Because here's a guy that is going to find holes. He's going to find cutbacks. He's going to straight arm guys. He's going to keep his feet moving. He is what a running back, you know, if you said, how do you make a running back, or you want to put one together, what are the tools they have to have, you just say number 20 blue.
He got 15 yards on that carry. Here's Mitchell on the play pass. Incomplete, intended for Morton. Ooh.
You can't throw a post pattern when the weak safety's sitting there.
Mangum back to knock it down. Our Aflac trivia question: who were the last two Detroit Lions to wear number 20 before Barry Sanders? And I'll give you a clue. They were both pretty good players.
And I'll give you another clue, that the guy who coached one of the guys the wore number 20 was in the booth just about an hour ago.
That's right.
And his name is Jim David.
And he was a tough guy. Here's Mitchell. Out to Sanders. Field, two of his patented moves. Two Bears had shots and two Bears missed.
Yeah, he can do it all. I mean, here's Barry Sanders here. You see, and Mitchell's looking this way, trying to look off these linebackers, to hold the linebackers, to let Barry Sanders get out here. You see Mitchell coming back and looking out to his left, and then when he comes off it, they have gotten off Barry Sanders. Now, if you get off Barry Sanders, he is going to make a lot of guys miss because there's no one up pressure him right now, so he has time to think about those moves.
He doesn't need much time.
You can't be embarrassed when you miss a tackle of Barry Sanders.
On first down, it's Morton to the 7 from Mitchell.
See, and Barry Sanders gets him going. I mean, he got him going with the run and then the pass to him. Then you see out here, Johnny Morton again against that presser tight coverage. That time he went up and ran in and ran a slant, which is a better pattern against tight coverage than the other ones they were trying to run when they ran that short out and the hook. A slant is better against press coverage.
First and goal at the 8. Barry Sanders is still in the game. Mitchell scrambling, fires, and throws it out of bounds. Herman Moore was in the area.
See, now that time he can throw the ball away. Once you get outside the area where the normal tight end would line up, you can throw the ball away if you get it back to the line of scrimmage. Here's an area where you would think that the Lions would try and go to Herman Moore. You know, for years they've run that fade, you know, because he's so tall and he just jumps up there and they just get the ball up there where only he can get it.
Mark Thomas is the Bear shaken up.
Mark Thomas is a Bear who took Alonzo Spellman's place and really played well. Remember, we remember him from the 49ers when the playoffs championship game, he had some big games and was normally a pass rusher. Didn't play the run much, and then playing regular, he's been playing the run well also.
And gotten bigger. 17-3, the Bears lead.
This Fox NFL special is brought to you by Volkswagen. On the road of life, there are passengers and there are drivers.
Mitchell up under the center calling the play. Second down and goal. Mitchell to Moore. Touchdown.
Yeah, that's the one that I was talking about. You use Herman Moore's height and you just throw it up there where he can get it. Going to jump ball. Herman Moore is one of the taller wide receivers in football at 6'3". And you see, you just run that fade and just run the jump ball and let him use his height and his body and just make a basketball catch.
And the strength in his hands. He has tremendous hands.
And he is so proud of those hands and the fact that he catches the ball with and in his hands. He works on that all the time.
Jason Hansen for the extra point. Jets the holder. 17-10. 6:05 left to play in the first half. Mitchell to Moore, and it's 17-10. The Bears lead. At the Pontiac Silverdome, happy Thanksgiving. Pat Summerall with John Madden, 17-10. The Bears lead Detroit. Herman Moore, who just scored the Lion touchdown.
And he does all those things that, you know, Herman Moore is noted for. He uses his height and his body to catch that ball. Walt Harris was really pretty good. Herman Moore really just took it away from him.
That's right. Fabian Bowens. Back to return the kick, and he's outside the 25 to the 27. Corey Schlesinger.
Yeah, we talked about Herman Moore and how proud he is of his hands. He showed us these cards. He had all the cards, and what he liked was how his eyes are looking right at the ball, and he thinks that's one of the most important. You have your hands together, and your eyes look the ball into your hands. Look at that. Those are the pictures that he has, his football cards that he carries around to remind himself to use your hands and look the ball into your hands. Herman Moore, one of the good guys, too, by the way.
Yes, he is. First and 10 Bears at their own 27. Kramer. The John Allred. Our Aflac question again. Remember, who were the last two Detroit Lions to wear number 20 before Barry Sanders? We told you they were pretty good. One of them, Lim Barney. And then Billy Sims.
And we're talking about Jim David. Jim David was a defensive back for years for the Detroit Lions. Later a coach. He coached Lem Barney. In fact, he gave the induction speech for Lem Barney at the Hall of Fame when he was inducted into the Hall of Fame.
Flag on the play as Kramer gives to Raymond Harris for a short pickup. But it looked like the Lions might have jumped.
It was interesting yesterday talking to Raymond Harris. He says that he normally gets well on Thursday. You know, I mean, he starts to feel normal on Thursday for the next Sunday's game.
On the defense, number 92, 5-yard penalty, repeat second down.
Number 92 is Mark Spindler. He's a tackle right in here, and you're just going to see him jump right there. See, he just takes off right there. And I thought when I saw the play, I thought, geez, he got a lot of penetration and got his arm in there. And the reason he got the penetration is he left before the ball was snapped.
Second and one. Harris should have gotten enough for the first. Word on the injury to Mark Thomas is that he has a bruised thigh and should be able to return.
Yeah, you know what happened? He ran right into his own guy. He was just running down the field, and he was following Brian Cox, and he just bumped into Brian Cox and fell down.
These Lions are 6-6 and still in the playoff hunt. The Bears playing for Bear Pride. Here's Kramer. Gets it to Ryan Wetnight for a short gain, about 3 yards.
You know, you wonder sometime why teams have success and then they go away from the success and they go back to throwing short passes for none yards. I mean, they have a rookie playing corner out there in Kevin Abrams. They gave him some motion and he came off of coverage. He broke a coverage and they hit a big one to Ricky Prohl. And you wonder why they don't go back to it. I mean, why they don't say, okay, we got a rookie corner playing out there. I mean, you have a rookie on the other side too, but he's been playing all the time, Westbrook. But you go over there to your left side, their right side, and say, why don't we work over there? Why don't we do something over there? We can do it. We've done it before.
At least until they stop it.
There it is right there.
Yep. And the pass to Chris Penn, a strike from Kramer.
Yep, someone must have thought the same thing. You know, what are we throwing those none-yard passes for when we have Kevin Abrams over there at corner? Let's go to work on him. Here he is right over here. You see he has that press coverage or that tight coverage. And you're going to see Kramer's going to come back here. He looks to the right. You see, and you just get right by him because Abrams is trying to play tight coverage, but he doesn't use his hands at all. He's not putting his hands on the receiver. He's not getting any kind of bump. So you can get by him, boom, right off the bat.
First and 10 Bears at the Detroit 25. Raymond Harris back to the line of scrimmage, stopped by Luther Ellis. He got a piece of equipment with it. Sole shoe.
Well, you just go in and you get anything you can. Yep. You know, people are like, oh, the guy uses this, you aim at this, you aim at this. If you're a big old tackle like Luther Ellis, you just go in there and you just grab anything you can. I mean, you grab an ankle, a knee, a thigh, a leg. Whatever.
A shoe. Luther Ellis might be getting a piece of that turkey leg the way he's playing.
Yeah, Raymond Harris starts off with a shoe and wonders what the heck happened when he went in the hole. He had a shoe when he came out. He didn't.
Darnell Autry is the deep back. Allred was the man on the move. Kramer gets it to Penn. And Penn will move the stick, stopped by Westbrook.
Yeah, Chris Penn 2 weeks ago had a terrible game. Came back last week with a better game, and he looks like he's just continuing today from last Sunday.
2 minutes left, first half. Troy Aikman and Emmett Smith, 1990 Turkey Leg Award winners. Better days then for the Cowboys.
Better days then for the Cowboys, but not better days for the turkey legs. Did you see that turkey leg and that tinfoil on it? That was one of our bad years where someone on the turkey, you know, when you're giving a turkey
leg. You gotta unwrap it.
No, you just grabbed the thing. But watch this. I mean, it has tinfoil or whatever they call that foil. Well, look at Troy's face. He's even looking. He said he can't believe that. You give a guy a turkey leg and then you put tinfoil all over.
I think they call that aluminum foil.
That was a low moment in our turkey leg award.
Here's Eric Kramer. The end zone and out for Curtis Conway.
Holy moly. Did you see Curtis Conway when he hit that wall? Looked a little like Gus Frerotte. Although he hit a square.
He knows how to hit it.
I know. If you're ever going to hit a wall, you run into it, a headbutt, you run into it with the top of your head. I mean, the front of your head. You don't run in with the top of your head. Look at that. Hey, Kramer, hit head here. But if you do it like a headbutt, you do it with your forehead. You butt something with your forehead, not the crown of your head.
Second and 10, two tight ends.
That was a messed up play. Someone went the wrong way.
Bobby Ross obviously wants a timeout. And they got it done. Don't forget, coming up at the half, we'll send you back to the studios for the Dockers Khakis halftime. JB, Terry, Howie on Ronnie, all on scene. First half analysis, the Fox Sports ticker. And an interview with Mike Ditka, who said one day this game has passed me by, and the next day he caught it and came back.
Well, you know, the game needs the Mike Ditkas of this world. I mean, this is a game, and I don't care what you say. I mean, big money, this and that. One of the great things about the game is it's played with emotion. And it has to be coached with emotion and watched with emotion. And anytime there's no emotion in it, then you don't have a game anymore.
Anytime you get Mike Ditka, you're going to get emotion.
Yeah, and you have to. And, and they say that this isn't something you lose or whatever, but it's still, it's your whole life. I mean, I said, like Dave Wannstedt pours his whole life into winning. Bobby Ross does. Mike Ditka does. I mean, that's what you are. And when you lose, I swear, it devastates you. It's devastating.
Third down, two tight ends. Kramer back to throw. Fires outside to Ryan Wetnight. Gets down to about the 14.
Yeah, I'll never understand
why
that. They do that on Thanksgiving, too. They can get, you got the rookie corner out there. Why not work deep? I mean, why throw and complete a pass and then still have to kick the field goal? That makes no sense to me. If you're going to throw the pass, throw it where if you catch it, it's a first down at least, or a touchdown.
Tuesday, Fox presents a star-studded salute to six of television's most popular comic geniuses in the funniest and most touching comedy event of the year, the American Comedy Honors, Tuesday at 8, 7 Central, right here on Fox.
Hey, although the Bears have played very well in this first half, I mean, there's a team, they've only won two games all year, they have a short week, they have to travel, and you'd think that they'd be kind of down or lethargic. Not at all.
Jeff Jaeger from 32 yards out. His field goal is good. There is our tape room. Guys you don't normally see. And a happy Thanksgiving to you, too.
There's Carmen passing kisses to everyone.
Mario
doesn't pass kisses to everyone. Dan Steele, look at her. That's a good sign of a cameraman. When a cameraman can't find another camera, that's a good sign. A bad sign is when a cameraman can't find the field. But Dan Steele there, he just couldn't find the other camera.
We all had dinner together last night, along with, as John Madden mentioned, the officials for today's game.
Yeah, and that's our tradition. I mean, that's what we do on Thanksgiving.
Well, that's sort of our family.
No, it has been. I mean, it's been for 17 years. We've been doing this together on Thanksgiving, and there's Bruce up here.
Yeah.
He's looking for the field.
Happy Thanksgiving.
But you think there's no place you'd rather be, and I think everyone's happy to be here. Now, that's some kind of thing. You know what that's called? That's called a jib. And it has, like, weights on it, and you go it up and down.
You know what a jib is, but not an emu, huh?
I don't know what a jib is either. I just said you go it up and down. That's not even a sentence.
Glenn Milburn has had a couple of outstanding returns.
He has a good wedge in there, and he's been getting good blocking by the wedge. And you know, he'll take it right up to the wedge and then run off away from the wedge. Watch this one. Watch him with wedge again. See, boom, he gets right up into the wedge and runs right around it.
Watch number one right there. Well, he's out of the picture.
What happened to old number one?
He got knocked down.
After the ball went by.
After the parade passed him by.
So he missed the tackle, the parade passed him by, and then he got knocked down and out of order?
Right. Mitchell to Morton. That's a first down.
And this is why Bobby Ross took that timeout when the Bears had the ball, knowing that if they hold them, get a field goal, they'd get the ball back and get another shot before halftime.
They have one timeout left. Mitchell. Back to throw it. To Moore. Good catch. Outstanding catch by Herman Moore.
Herman Moore, an outstanding receiver. I mean, he's one of those guys that can get open and will do anything to catch the ball. Watch, he's coming here. He's going to run an out move right here. And then Mitchell just leads him right to the outside perfectly.
Got both feet down.
Herman
Another
Moore.
First down. Excuse
he
me.
Does all those things right.
First and 10, clock stop with just over a minute left. Moore to Sloan to the 40. Now they've got one timeout left, remember.
And Scott Mitchell has to think right now that he needs about another 10 yards. He has to get inside the 30 to be in true field goal range.
How could look at the cables?
Happy holidays.
You wonder how all that stuff yep. gets around and then get plugged in.
I've been doing this a while, and I've always wondered.
Or what I can't figure out is how someone doesn't pull a plug out, and then nothing works.
And that never happens. Second and six at the Bear 40. Mitchell gives to Sanders. Sanders has got some room to operate. Sanders inside the 10, touchdown.
Unbelievable.
Can he accelerate?
What a call. You use your last timeout. You don't have any timeouts left. And you say, what are we going to do? What's our best play? Does Scott Mitchell throw it to Herman Moore? No, you run a draw play to Barry Sanders and let him do this. This is unbelievable. The call was unbelievable. The blocking was unbelievable. And the run at that point in this game is unbelievable.
47-yard touchdown run by Barry Sanders, and you should be thankful for that guy. Boy, he can put some excitement into any contest.
Great coaching by Bobby Ross, where they took the timeout when the Bears had the ball, knew that they were going to get it, and then do this.
Just watch this.
Look at the moves and the vision. Look at the vision. I mean, he sees everything. And then right here, he switches the ball in the midst of all that, and his eyes are looking. Look, he's looking right, he's looking left, he's feeling everything, and then right at the end here, he puts on a little burst, a little explosion. That's a pretty good mixture.
I'll tell you what. You talk about instinctive runners, you talk about accomplished runners, you talk about guys who can accelerate, guys who have great vision.
Hey, you talk about what a great call. I mean, to
yeah.
use a timeout, have no more timeouts left, so you know that once you run the ball, you're going to have to get up and you know throw it down if he doesn't score a touchdown.
We overuse the word great so many times, but not when it applies to Barry Sanders.
I think that's one time that you have freedom of the use of the word.
About 2 yards deep in the end zone, downs it. It's worth looking at that run from a different angle again.
Well, he gets some good blocks up there at the line of scrimmage. You know, it's a draw play, so what they're trying to do is make the Bears think it's a pass, you see, and they're getting up there in their pass rush, so he gets by that first group quickly.
And you think somebody coached him to change hands with the ball?
No, I don't think anyone coached Barry Sanders to do what he does. I think those things are all instinct. And I don't, you know, and he was even telling us yesterday that until he sees a run that he makes on film, even he doesn't know what he did. I mean, if you ask Barry Sanders now, what happened on that run, what would you do? He said he may know half of it, but he wouldn't know the other half.
The Bears lead it 20-17. That's Raymond Harris. The Bears have all three of their timeouts left. The Lions used theirs judiciously, would you say?
Yeah, very well. Very well coached. That part of the game by using the timeout when the Bears had the ball, getting the ball back, and then making a couple of passes. Great catch by Herman Moore. And then, you know, when it works, a draw play to Barry Sanders. An excellent call and a great run. I think the Bears are just trying to run the clock out and get out of there with a lead of 20-17.
Encroachment on the defense, number 94. 5-yard penalty.
Luther Ellis.
Still second down.
Luther Ellis is right here. Detroit's playing a three-man line. And again, what he was trying to do is flinch to get Chris Valerio, the center, to snap the ball. And he flinched with his right hand, seeing he was going to get Valerio to flinch. Valerio, the center, didn't flinch.
But he got knocked backwards.
He got canned. Remember the old deal, canned the center?
Ellis again, John. Pass complete to Ryan Wetnight. No flag, so the flinch was not severe enough for a penalty.
Well, that's just a game that they play in the pits. You know, there more and more defensive linemen are doing that, mm-hmm. You know, given that, you know, that flinch move and then trying to get the offensive guy to move. Brian Cox there didn't talk this week. He didn't want to be captain. He didn't want to call the defenses in the huddle. He's not today. Barry Minter is. He said last week, remember, he got that 15-yard penalty. Then he got another penalty for arguing with the officials. And he said he's not going to talk to anyone. He's not going to talk to any officials. He said he doesn't want to have to call a flip. He doesn't want anything. So they're letting Barry Minter, number 92, do that. You know, he's calling the defenses in the huddle, you know, that tells the linemen and the linebackers in the secondary what they're doing.
He's the captain.
That's a good sign when you put something up to your nose and it sticks.
There's Kramer. Pass is caught by Ricky Prohl. And he calls a timeout.
Yeah, I thought back there the Bears were just going to run out the clock
too.
And be satisfied, and then they got something going. They got that penalty there when Luther Ellis jumped off sides, and that stopped the clock. And then Dave Wanstead said, what the heck, let's go after him. Let's do something out here. And they had success with this earlier, and you wonder why they just don't go back to it. You know, just throwing to the tight end and throwing deep to their outside receiver. Again, especially over there on the rookie, Kevin Abrams.
Pretty good day for Ricky Prohl. Three catches, 160 yards.
How about that rack, which is run after the catch, was 92 yards, and most of that was on that blitz when he was a hot receiver and he caught that slant.
Ricky Prohl's already had a career high for yards gained.
And I think they can still take a shot over there
on
Kevin Abrams. I mean, I think that's if they're going to do something, you'd think over there on that left side that you were going to do something, you'd take a shot over here.
Eric Kramer's thrown the ball well. From behind, strip. Ball's loose. The Lions obviously saying, we've got it.
Tracy Scroggins came from the backside. Eric Kramer was looking downfield. The Lions did get the ball, but the half is over.
That's the end of the first half with the score Chicago 20, Detroit 17. This Fox NFL special will continue with the Dockers Khakis halftime report after these messages and a word from your local Fox station.
Dockers Halftime, brought to you by Dockers Khakis. Eat turkey and watch football in style. Hey, nice pants.
The beauty of Barry Sanders, you never know when it's going to happen. He had 6 carries for 17 yards until this run. Takes it 40 yards, slippery, easing his way to pay dirt. He's 51 yards away from becoming the second all-time NFL rushing leader. Barry Sanders, Bears on top by 3 as we welcome you back here. Ronnie Lott, Howie Long, Terry Bradshaw, and yours truly, James Brown. You know, again, Detroit looking good, but give Chicago some credit. As we said during the pregame show, they aren't giving up.
Well, we said also on the show that the thing was to go to the outside on these young rookie corners, Westbrook and Abrams, and look at Rookie Proulx, what he's done in the first half, 160 yards in receptions already, Ronnie.
That's right. You talked about the sugar, and the sugar definitely was on the outside. That's what you have to do. You got to throw the ball to the outside, as well as Ryan Wetnight, the tight end, was able to get up the middle, and that's what they have to continue to do.
233 yards, the high for a receiver this year. Isaac Bruce versus Atlanta. Rookie Proulx on pace to break that right now. Throwing the ball over the top to Herman Moore, as we talked about in the pregame.
Detroit with a mark of 6-6. This game is huge for playoff implications with them. All right, folks, as the Dockers halftime continues, we will talk with the always candid Mike Ditka of the Saints after this. And welcome back to Dockers Halftime. Saints head coach Mike Ditka made news this week by saying after last Sunday's loss to the Falcons, he wasn't sure whether he was the right person to coach the team. On Monday, he said he made a mistake and he's in for the long haul. Earlier, we had a chance to talk with Ditka, and I asked him whether he regrets what he said.
Well, my true feeling is that I want to fulfill the obligation I took on when I came here for Mr. Benson and this organization. I want to do the best job I can. I said I wanted to come here for 3 years and see what happened. If it works in 3 years, I'll be here for a long time. I was dead wrong on Sunday, but in the heat of frustration and disappointment, I said some very stupid things. But it's not the first time, James.
and it won't be the last either, will it, Coach?
That's right.
You have you went out and you brought in Heath Shuler. You brought in some people. You've gone down the line in quarterbacks. Your quarterback position, you have to be extremely frustrated with. Is quarterback something you're going to address again this offseason?
Terry, what's happened to us really is we don't make plays. You know, whether it's a quarterback or the receiver or the running back, we just aren't making plays on offense. It's very simple, and as you know, having played the position, it's very easy to blame the quarterback for a lot of problems. First of all, it starts with the offensive line. If you don't protect, you know, you're not going to throw the ball very well. Heath Shuler's not a dead issue at all. I think he's going to come back. He's injured right now. He's out for the year. We're going to go with Billy Joe Hobart. I think it's going to be interesting. This kid is he's an interesting guy. I like him. He's my kind of guy. Reminds me a little bit of McMahon. And, you know, McMahon and I were good friends for a long time.
Hey, Mike, it's Howie Long. I, for one, I'm glad you came to your senses. I think there's a place in pro football for Mike Ditka as a coach. And first of all, when you take the job in New Orleans, what surprised you most about what's transpired so far this year? Did you overestimate the talent, maybe?
Yeah, I did. I think that's the biggest thing I did wrong. I thought we'd be a lot better right now. You know, as good as we're playing on the defensive side of the ball, Howie, we should have 3 or 4 more wins. That's a fact. Nobody can deny that. Our defense has played their hearts out, and they played hard. We've done a really respectable job with the special teams also.
Coach, this is Ronnie Lott. I'm curious about the players today, their commitment to the game. I know we've talked about Love Fest. I mean, has that frustrated you? Has that got you in this situation where you feel like I'm not living up to being a great coach?
Well, I think the thing that you and I talked about, Ronnie, it's hard to create loyalty. You know, it's hard to say, why does anybody want to play for this team? You know, it's hard for me to say, yeah, I think it'd be special if you want to play for the Saints. We're going to do something here. We're going to make some changes. We're going to win. It's hard to get people to do that. You know, there are a few winning organizations that have the ability to do that a little bit. The 49ers do that. But that's what we're trying to create here. But people say, hey, should I stay there? You're not winning. You don't have this. You don't have that. I'll go somewhere where the money is. That's the only thing that bothers me. I wish that we could create loyalties. But, you know, it's everybody's fault. You know, the NFL's fault as well as the players' fault. You know, we've broken down a barrier there, we've built a barrier there, rather. There's no loyalty between anybody. I want some loyalty. I want only people who want to play here. And that may not win for me in the beginning, but in the end, it will win.
Are you concerned that if in 3 years this thing doesn't work, that what you've accomplished in the past in Chicago is going to be somewhat tainted a little bit?
Only if I believe the glory of my life is not going to be on this earth. If I know it's not going to be on his search, what difference does it make? What happened in Chicago is such a distant memory to me, I can't even remember it, I swear. I can remember the players, but I don't remember what happened.
Hey, Coach, we thank you very much for being very candid with us, and success to you the rest of the way, and we look forward to you being in the NFL for quite some time to come.
Thank you, James.
We'll rejoin Pat and John for the second half of the Bears-Lions contest. All of that after this.
You're watching a Fox NFL Thanksgiving Day special.
This first half highlight is brought to you by 1-800-COLLECT. And what else could it be but that run by Barry Sanders?
And again, that was, you know, so great because, you know, it's Barry Sanders and he's running a draw. But the call when the Lions had no timeouts to say, okay, what are we going to call? I mean, should Scott Mitchell throw the ball? Should we do this? Should we get the ball out of bounds? Should we get the ball in the end zone? And someone made the decision, no, let's hand it to Barry Sanders on a draw.
And Mark Trestman, of course, is the man who works with the quarterbacks for the Lions. So he'll give him Bobby Ross credit. John. Go ahead.
No, I was just saying that, you know, one of the big surprises has to be the Chicago Bears' pass yards, 249 yards, 292 yards total, 13 first downs. I mean, that is a good offense.
Mm-hmm.
And I think, you know, when you think of this game and the first half of this game, it's an excellent game. You know, because we kind of had it all. We've had, you know, a little defense. We've had both teams going at each other. We've had good special teams play. We've had good passes, you know, good long passes by Eric Kramer. Good, of course, long run by Barry Sanders right there at the end of the half. That's not bad football for a Thanksgiving day, huh?
How about Barry's son when we met him yesterday? Looks just like him.
Yeah, Barry James. He's 3 years old, and one of the coaches was walking around saying, if I were a college coach, I'd give that kid a scholarship right now.
The flag on the play back from where the ball is clipped. Milburn gets around the corner and heads it up the field. Knocked out of bounds at about the 30.
Yeah, the Bears kickoff coverage is going to figure this out pretty soon. And they're going to have to stay in their lanes if they can't converge on the wedge, because Milburn's doing the same thing every time, taking the ball into the wedge and then breaking it to the outside.
Walt Coleman, the referee.
You see, anytime you see an official with his hat off, that means that there's something that happened on the sideline or the guy has multiple fouls. Yep, looked like multiple fouls.
Yes, it did. He ran out of flags and hats. Walt Coleman, by the way, is from Little Rock. And the dairy business.
Now, Walt Coleman at first said one was on the Bears and one was on the Lions. And that last one, I think he said it was both against the
Personal
Bears.
Foul on the kicking team, number 38, face mask, 15 yards, and a first down.
Well, he only gave one signal
yeah,
that time.
Well, the flag's down back at the 35-yard line.
And you see it right there. That's exactly what it was. He was going down. He was being blocked. In fact, it happened right here in front of us. And as he was going down, he just grabbed a face mask on the way down to hold himself up.
So after all that, the Lions take over at their own 44-yard line, first and 10. 20-17, Chicago leads. Three wide receivers to open the second half for Scott Mitchell. This is a big game for Detroit. Well, you can see Green Bay, the leader in the NFC Central, 9-3. Minnesota, Tampa Bay, 8-4. Detroit, 6-6. Chicago, 2-10. But Detroit still has playoff hopes.
especially the way Minnesota and Tampa Bay played last Sunday. First, Tampa Bay lost to the Chicago Bears Sunday.
This is Sanders. They almost broke another one. He does get to the line, to the Bear 35.
You know what Barry Sanders was saying yesterday is that he kind of gets warmed up as the game goes on. And you see here, just one back. He says he kind of likes one back because you can get to the hole a little quicker. You don't have to wait for a fullback. That time, he had to wait for his offside because that was a counter. So he took a little step to the left, then his left guard and tackle pull around to lead him to the right side. That's a counter part of it.
It ought to be a sight to behold if we go into overtime. Here's Sanders again. Still on his feet. Close to a first down. He had 9 carries for 78 yards before that.
Yeah, Barry Minter missed him, and he couldn't believe that he missed him, and he hit himself in the head. You know, he's going to come up, and the thing is, you have to get to Barry Sanders, and then you have to wrap up. And you see right there, Brian Cox misses him. Barry Minter missed him right there, and they finally got him down at the end. And then all the guys that missed him just kind of rose up and just collectively hit their heads.
Third and short. Sanders got the first inside the Bear 30. Minter made the stop. How do you tackle him? If you get over-aggressive, he's going to make you miss.
Well, and that's what happened. Marty Carter, the safety, came up, and he got penetration into the backfield. So he was trying to make him stop or redirect or something, and then he did. He just bounced right around Marty Carter and got to the outside and got the first down. So the Bears know what they're doing. They have guys there in the right location. Maybe the best thing is like this, tire them out a little where the coaches bring them out and give them a rest.
Ron Rivers is in the game at the deep back with Vardell in front of him. And Mitchell will throw. Herman Moore comes down with the ball inside the 5. That's good coverage. That's just an excellent catch.
That's the play that Scott Mitchell was telling us yesterday. He just calls that a fade, and it's not a stop fade. And he looks at the coverage. See, you have tight coverage up here on Herman Moore. Now, he's going to throw him a fade. Now, if Herman Moore gets beyond the defender, Walt Harris, he's going to lead him out. If he's even, he's going to throw it short like he did that time and make him come back and catch the ball like this. So he said, we don't call it a fade stop. That was a fade stop. They only call it a fade, and Scott Mitchell makes a decision.
First and goal. Mitchell scrambles out of the pocket and gets that knocked out of bounds by Barry Minter. Couldn't find anything in the end zone.
This is when Bobby Ross says that he hates this. Anytime he sees Scott Mitchell rolling out to his left, he said, bad things usually happen. We haven't seen an interception yet. But here he had to because he had to scramble. But he said he's just not a good thrower when he goes out to his left. You know, and Steve Young, you know, like, yeah, I mentioned earlier, is excellent at that.
Sanders is in on the goal line. Ball's at the 4. He usually doesn't play. Once they get down here, Vardell's in front of him. Mitchell. Incomplete, intended for Herman Moore.
Yeah, this isn't a bad area here for Barry Sanders at the 4-yard line, because teams usually don't go to a goal line defense until they get to the 2-yard line. So at the 4-yard line, you still have them playing normal defense, and this isn't a bad Barry Sanders area. Where they don't like Barry Sanders is when they get down to the 2-yard line and in.
Would you guess he gets the ball this time?
I would give it to him.
Yeah. Third and goal at the 4.
I would have given it to him on second down, though, too.
He doesn't get the ball.
And they don't get a first down.
And Mitchell goes down. They're going to have to settle for the field goal attempt. Carl Simpson.
Yeah, that's good defense by the Bears and good coverage. There's just nothing open there because they're holding up there, and they got... And they have good coverage downfield. Mitchell, when he comes up to pass and doesn't see anything, he takes his eyes off his receivers and looks down at his rushers.
So Jason Hansen has made one already today. This one's from 29 yards out. Hansen, one of the better kickers, with a lot of power. He ties the score. So it's the Bears 20, the Lions 20.
This Fox NFL special is brought to you by the coaches of Nike Play Corps, by Southwest Airlines, proud sponsor of the NFL and official airline of the Super Bowl, by Mazda, come see what happens when a car company has more engineers and fewer accountants, Mazda, and by the new Wizard Rotary Tool, the tool that knows no limits, built by Black & Decker.
20-20 tie at the Pontiac Silverdome, the Bears and the Lions. On Thanksgiving Day, a tradition since 1934. They obviously didn't play here in 1934.
Well, they played here in Detroit.
Yeah.
Not here in this stadium.
Well, they were in Pontiac. They played in Detroit at the University of Detroit. Bowens cut down and still down.
That was a heck of a play by Bryant Westbrook, the starting corner. Let's look at the Bears and see what, you know, 0 for 5, you know, between 0 and 5 yards, or 3 out of 7 for 9 yards, 6 to 10, 2 out of 2. Now, these are the two areas, the 11 to 15 yards where they're 3 out of 4 for 70 yards, and the 16 plus where they're 4 for 4 for 162 yards. That is big for the Chicago Bears today, and it's big for them in this season. I mean, that's what they had to do.
Here's Bowens.
And watch Bryant Westbrook right there. Whew.
20-20 tie. Eric Kramer, when he was a Lion, joined by Jerry Ball as the Turkey Leg winners in 1991. Eric Kramer as a Chicago Bear. Gives to Raymond Harris. Fabian Bowens over on the sideline has a hip pointer.
Yeah, that was on the kickoff return. Bryant Westbrook came flying down the field, and it looks like he just hit him right on the hip in the tackle.
His return, they say, is questionable. I don't think he'll be back. That could be very painful.
It's one of those things, those hip pointers, where no matter what part of your body you move, it hurts right there, and sneezing and coughing, and sometimes it even hurts to talk.
Second and 10. Eric Kramer. Pass is dropped by Ryan Wetnight.
I'll tell you one thing, they're taking care of this Bear offensive line, are handling Mike Wells and Luther Ellis now. In fact, Ellis on that one tried a spinner, and they just stayed right with him. I mean, just watch. This is what a spinner looks like. You see Ellis? In fact, he got spun around.
He
His
got
old man
into a spin.
Him, he started to spin, and he got hit right in the face mask.
Third and 10.
But that's what they do in the pitch. I mean, they just always going, you know, grunt and go man to man and square and all that. They do spinners and stuff down in there.
Three wide receivers. This is Ricky Pro on the move. And Kramer gets his pass out to Tony Carter, who gets out to the 20, and not enough for a first down, and the Bears will have to punt.
Anytime you get a third and long, this is Luther Ellis again, you know there's going to be a pass, so you're working pass rush off the way, all the way. He starts on Todd Perry. He tries to get inside, and by the time he gets outside, the ball's gone.
Todd Sauerbrunn gets off another good punt that chases Milburn back to his own 24. It's a little stagger. Bought him some time, and he turns it into a pretty good return out to the 40. 20-20 tie, 8:45 left in the third. Eight we've had. Three we haven't had.
No, he wasn't sure how many. I mean, he didn't know how many they had, but he knew one thing. They don't have eight, and he's right. I mean, you know, you get your basic legged turkey, and then sometimes, you know, for whatever reason, they'll grow another leg or two, but they never, ever grow eight.
first and 10, Detroit. Mitchell back to throw. Gets it outside to Herman Moore. Moves back to the inside, then back outside for a first down. This game summary brought to you by Budweiser. Eric Kramer, 13 out of 19. One touchdown pass, that to Ricky Prohl. Barry Sanders, 11 rushes, 84 yards, one touchdown. And Glenn Milburn, return yards, 232.
And that's why the Detroit Lions have had such great field position all day.
First down, Detroit. Just in Bear territory. Mitchell back to throw. Ooh, almost picked off and then caught by Kez McCarvey.
He was doing a good job as is Juan Roque, the right tackle right here. I mean, he's doing a heck of a job. He's blocking Brian Cox here, and he's only a rookie, and he's a big guy, and he's been given a lot of protection today so that some of these things can happen out here. I think that Scott Mitchell didn't see, he thought that was a man-to-man, and he threw right into the teeth of his own defense on that one.
Second and 7. Sanders wrapped up in the backfield for a loss by Anthony Marshall.
Well, I was really impressed with Juan Roque yesterday when I saw him. He was standing out on the sideline here in practice. I was standing behind him, and I don't know that I've ever seen an offensive lineman that big.
He's huge.
He's like 6'8", 320 pounds, and just a big guy. I guess I have seen guys that big, but it just seemed like standing behind him that this is one of the biggest guys I've ever seen in my life.
Their second round draft choice. He looks like a good pick.
Yeah, and he's a good player. I mean, he's handled his side of the line very well today, both on run and pass.
Bear blitz coming. Mitchell going deep, got a man wide open. Johnny Morton from Scott Mitchell just pulled away from the pack.
They may not let Johnny Morton up. Oh, J-Mo. J-Mo catches that one and goes down, and you can't even find him anymore. He's going to start from the outside. And you watch this Bear defense. They have to get someone deep in the middle. And when they don't have anyone deep in the middle, and again, that's because of Barry Sanders. Here's Johnny Morton. He's the outside guy. He goes by in the post. There's no one deep. John Mangum isn't there deep. There's no one deep. He runs right by Walt Harris. Mangum is up again. They're worried about Barry Sanders. I'm sure that's why they're up there shallow. Then you can get that deep post in behind him.
Extra point is good.
But no matter how you play, you have to have someone deep in the middle or they are going to get the post.
Johnny Morton, the third straight Thanksgiving game he has scored.
Yep.
There's the bus.
Yep, came here from Green Bay last weekend, and there's Willie Yarbrough, the driver, and Joe Mitchell.
And the turkey.
There's the turkey.
One, two, low three, and four, five. Six legs?
Yeah, well, one, two, three. And you got four, five, six, seven.
That's a leg around there?
No, I just put one in. I mean, if you're going to do something, you can do anything you want to do.
That's a fork and some dressing.
I don't want that one.
Nah.
I want to get rid of those grapes underneath, too. Yeah, that's the first thing you do. You know, they call that stuff garnish. First thing you do on Thanksgiving is throw all garnish away.
Tyrone Hughes gets it out to good return by Tyrone Hughes outside the 30-33.
Let's watch the touchdown again. You know, we always talk about Barry Sanders and how well he runs, but if you're going to be back here, you have to be able to block. Watch the block that he gets. We're talking about Juan Roque. Watch the block that he gets on Cox. Now, these things have to happen to give Mitchell time. And he's going to come back there and have time. Mangum has to get deep in the middle. He is held right there. You see, when he's held there, then Johnny Morton is able to get in behind him because he has already gotten behind the right corner, Walt Harris.
First and 10 at their own 34 for the Bears. Lions ahead by seven. Kramer behind Tony Carter for McDonald's game break. Let's again return to James Brown at the Fox Television Center in Hollywood.
Hey, Pat, here's one of Madden's all-time defensive greats, the multi-dimensional talent known as Lawrence Taylor. Not only terrorizing with his tackling ability, good hands as well as he returns this interception 97 yards for a score that helped the Giants to upend Detroit back on Thanksgiving Day 1982. Back to Pat and John.
I do remember that. That's when I knew that a defensive player could dominate a football game, because he did in that game.
Second and 10, Raymond Harris. A couple of yards and that's all. Mike Wells made the stop. Raymond Harris was saying his right thumb is bad, his right, the ribs on his right side, the right hip,
the right shoulder.
Right shoulder.
In fact, he had surgery and he has a plate in his right shoulder, and he said, well, it's really not the plate. He said, it's right around the plate. The plate part of it's okay.
Good spot for some garnish.
But it's hard. It's hard for a running back. You know, it takes so many hits in a football game to get ready to play and be fresh on a short week like this.
Third and about eight. Here comes the blitz. You saw Kramer pointing to it. The ball's loose. Looks like Detroit recovered. Yes, they did.
Dave Juan said, saying they had everything going so well. The first half, they were almost perfect. And stuff like this starts to happen. And again, we talked about Luther Ellis. You know, he's up there in front, and he's causing problems with Chris Valerio, the center. You know, he's been doing those jerk things, those starts, and doing all those things, making him very conscious of them.
You know, Kramer was concerned from the time they set up on offense. He started pointing and pointing.
And I think that's one thing that a quarterback can't do. He can't be concerned about what they're going to do. His line has to call it. His line has to block it. And he just has to worry about looking downfield and completing passes and not worry about the protection in front of him. Other people take care of that.
Excuse me. Three wide receivers. Sanders, the lone setback. It's like Mitchell's changing the play. The Bears show blitz. Sanders gets the carry. To the 25. Marlon Forbes took him out of bounds.
Yeah, we have our turkey up here and our turkey leg up here, and I don't know that Barry Sanders would want it, because he says he has 40 people here today, and I said, well, who's going to cook the Thanksgiving meal? And he said he doesn't know who, but he said he's sure that someone would. His sisters were baking pies yesterday.
We got to send out for some more legs if we're going to feed 40 people.
Well, no, just Barry Sanders. But you see the block on Juan Roque on that? I mean, he just took his guy and knocked him right to the outside, and that made a big hole there for Barry Sanders.
Sanders again. Shakes another. Sanders' touchdown is second of the day. It's amazing. Just amazing.
And he's the most unaffected guy by it. He just hands the ball to the official and goes back. Barry Sanders is the most respected player in the National Football League. What? I mean, guys just miss him. But, I mean, he sees everything. He knows what everyone's doing. He had a straight arm there on Marty Carter. And watch how he waits there. There's patience. He waits to get a block, let his blockers for him, and then take it into the end zone.
Well, he's broken all kinds of records. Set or tied today, the fifth 1,500-yard-plus straight rushing season. 11 straight 100-yard games. That breaks Marcus Allen's record.
May have been a better runner, but I have never seen him.
You just stand or sit and watch and marvel. Happy Thanksgiving, and it's been a happy day for Barry Sanders. He has just moved into second place on the all-time list, ahead of Eric Dickerson and just behind the great Walter Payton.
These fans are giving Barry Sanders and the Detroit Lions a standing ovation.
Tyrone Hughes with some room, and Hughes has only the kicker to beat. They slowed him down enough. Jason Hansen got an arm on him and slowed him down enough to keep him from going all the way.
You know, we talk about Barry Sanders, and we saw the vision and the way he looks at things and straight arms, but just watch his feet. I mean, these are the things that you have to do at the bottom of your body to make the top things work. But you notice that they're never spread out. I mean, his feet are always together at shoulder width. You notice that? They were never like 1 foot way out here, 1 foot way out here, like you're doing the splits or something. They were always shoulder width.
58-yard return by Tyrone Hughes. But the Bears, as they fumble the exchange again.
Yeah, that was John Allred, too. He moved on that one, so that's going to be a penalty against the Bears. But watch how he knows right here where he has his patience. And he knows right here that he has a blocker coming here in Herman Moore. And he just waits right there, and then boom! Herman Moore wipes out his guy, and Barry Sanders can just step in the end zone. But, you know, he not only knows where the tacklers are and who he has to beat his tacklers, but also where his blockers are coming from, and he can set them up.
The previous play, or the play they had the flag on, was a false start against Allred, so it's first and 15. Kramer outside behind Chris Penn. That's about the first inaccurate throw for Eric Kramer all day.
Yeah, and again, now being down, they're going to have to go to work, I think, like they started out the game, and try and get some of those deep things, because I still think they can do it. I mean, I still think that they can work out here on Kevin Abrams. The thing that they started on is still there.
Well, let's see where Ricky Prohl goes. This time Penn comes left and Conway is to the right. Second and 15. Prohl's not in the game. There's Kramer for Conway. A little too far.
Yeah, they're not really handling the pass rush now, and they could get some things open. They could get some things open deep, but to do that, your quarterback has to have time. And if they don't get Luther Ellis blocked again, then the quarterback is going to start getting up looking out his ear hole every play.
Third and 15, 4:53 left to play in the third quarter. Detroit 34, Chicago 20. Eric Kramer, third and 15. They're 2 out of 9 on third down. 3 wide receivers. Prohl's in the slot left. Kramer just has to fire it to avoid the blitz and the sack. Ellison Scroggins put the heat on.
Yeah, here's Scroggins here. Here's Ellison here. You're going to see the blitz coming. No one blocks Ellis. I mean, you know, they slide out. Now, you would think that they would know who 94 Blue is. And you'd think that, you know, you'd get Luther and say, let me get him. And if someone else is going to come, let him come from the outside. But let's not let Luther Ellis be unblocked.
Melbourne signals fair catch. Tomorrow begins a weekend of championship skating on Fox as Olympic hopefuls take to the ice. So catch the world champion, Tara Lipinski, and some of the world's best skaters as they compete in the Prime Star Skate International Champion Series. Coverage begins tomorrow at 8 Eastern and Pacific on Fox.
Luther Ellis is having a heck of a game.
Is I mean, he ever?
You know, last week we did the Green Bay Packers, and we talked about their dominance inside, and you have to be able to get those guys blocked, and it's the same thing here today.
Mitchell to Morton. Outside the 20, and a flag comes flying in. Two flags come flying in. It would indicate face mask.
Man, Cox better watch out. That's what he got in trouble for last week, talking to an official.
Said he wasn't going to do that.
Personal foul, face mask on the defense, number 26, 15 yards, first down.
Mangum is number 26.
Yeah, and it's going to come right there. You see John Mangum is a free safety, and as he comes in, he grabs Johnny Morton's face mask. You almost had a face mask right there.
Yep.
Johnny Morton breaks that tackle, and then as he starts to come in, see John Mangum, 26 here, he grabbed his face mask with his right hand. Those are things that are tough. I mean, those aren't penalties that you try and do. You're just trying to tackle anything that you can, and once in a while, you'll just end up grabbing a face mask.
Mitchell drops on first down, goes deep for Morton. No flags. No flags. Tom Carter, good coverage. Don't forget, coming up on Fox this Sunday, 49ers and the Chiefs, where John and I will be, Saints and the Panthers, the Rams, Redskins, Buccaneers against the Giants, that's a big one, Atlanta Falcons against Seattle. We'll be at Arrowhead in Kansas City. Nothing doing for Barry Sanders this time.
I don't know that you could just watch Barry Sanders and play the game the way Barry Sanders plays it, because there's not a lot of Barry Sanderses. But in a day when everyone is kind of full of themselves and, you know, celebrations and all those things, which have really become part of the game, a guy that just kind of plays and hands the ball to the official,
yeah,
and, you know, is now the different guy and kind of the refreshing guy.
Mitchell. Is picked off by Tom Carter, and Carter with the interception gets to the 33-yard line.
See, now Tom Carter was playing zone on that one so that he can turn and he can look in at the quarterback. And you're going to see him right here, and you see how he's turned, he's looking in at Mitchell, so when he throws that slant, Tom Carter can get the jump. You see how he's turned in? He's turned in, and he's watching the three. One, two, three-step drop. Now, he knows by the three-step drop and the receiver going in that that's going to be a slant, so Tom Carter jumped that slant.
Morton stopped. And Mitchell thought he was going to continue.
Yeah, and Morton stopped, I think, because Tom Carter jumped in front of him.
Yep.
The thing you have to worry about, that slant, when you take that three-step drop against the zone, that corner is key in your drop.
You don't stop. And Porsche from the other side.
Yep, that was both ends there. Eric Kramer did a good job of just holding on to that ball. His pass protection has really fallen apart. I mean, they're not only having the problems inside that we just showed, but now they're having the problems with those two defensive ends. And you see that even the receivers see that it's a sack. I mean, there's nothing that he could do, because even if a receiver were open, he's on his back. And you see, here's where it comes from. It comes from the both ends on this one. See, and they both get to Kramer at about the same time. Like I said, he was lucky that ball didn't pop out of there.
Very fortunate. Second down, about 12. Is to Raymond Harris, and Harris goes inside the 30 to about the 28.
You know, I think that any time a running back comes in and plays against the Lions and plays against Barry Sanders, I think they want to do their best too. Yeah, but they don't want, you know, everything to be Barry Sanders this, Barry Sanders that. They want to, you know, maybe they know that they're not as good as Barry Sanders, but they'd like to be in the same league with Barry Sanders.
Third and four, and not many in the same league with Barry Sanders.
Not as a runner. I mean, I think when you say pure runner, I mean, he's the best there is. And when you say pure runner, just running with the football, I have never seen a better one.
Well, you talk about running backs and who's the best. Emmitt Smith in his heyday. It's Porsche who comes off.
Yeah, I think Emmitt Smith, you know, when you talk about everything a running back has to do, you know, blocking, pass receiving, and running, I think was the best. When you just talk about pure running. Football.
Third and four. Kramer back to throw. Going to be out of bounds pass for Conway. Let him out of bounds.
Curtis Conway hasn't caught a pass today. Now, that was part of Kramer's fault, throwing it out of bounds, but it was also Conway's fault because he's too close to the sideline. Anytime you run it up like this, you have to give your quarterback room, not only deep, but you have to give him room to the sideline. See, he only had inches to his left, so yep. He can't throw it over his outside shoulder because Curtis Conway, in his pass pattern, didn't leave him any room to.
Jaeger, 2 for 2. No good. Wide left by Jaeger. So the Lions will take over. Back at the Silver Dome, Barry Sanders on first down gets the carry, gets back to the line of scrimmage, and that's about all.
Barry Sanders, the ball carrier. Still working on Robert Porche over there. You know, one of the things, the first time I watched a Detroit film, you know, we did a game earlier against the Giants, and then when I came back, the first thing I saw on film that I said, you know, the thing that's really improved about this Lion team is their defense, generally, and specifically their defensive line. And Porche was one of those guys, Scroggins, and of course, Luther Ellis and Wells inside.
They look a lot quicker, don't they?
Yeah, and they get off the ball, they have a lot more penetration.
Mitchell back to throw. Sure if he was in bounds or not. Incomplete.
I think they say J-Mo was out of bounds.
He got the knees down, but not the feet.
Watch him again. Now, he does give himself room here. You see, it's an adjustment. He was going to run a short pattern or a hook, and then he saw the coverage, and he just ran up the field. Well, he didn't even catch the ball.
No. So
it didn't make any difference if he had any feet or knees or anything in. Well, he did catch the ball.
Yeah.
So it does make any difference if he had, but he didn't have his feet in.
No. Third and 10, three wide receivers. Mitchell gives to Sanders. And Barry Sanders comes out of the pack.
This has to be some good calling. I mean, just that, you know, you get, you know, that down and distance was third down, 10 yards to go. Now, in any team in the National Football League, that is either a passing down or a give-up down. And when you just run, let's say it's third and 10, okay, what are we going to do? Let's run a counter. Let's run a counter to Barry Sanders and get our first down.
And he got almost no blocking.
Yeah, and that was like just before the halftime. You have no timeouts left. You have a play you can run. What are you going to run? You run a draw to Barry Sanders, and he gets you a touchdown. No wonder Chicago's taking a touchdown. They're completely frustrated, I think, with Barry Sanders.
We spoke to Barry Sanders about the impact his mother and father had on him.
What I am has everything to do with the kind of example that my parents set, and just being two hardworking people that, love, all their kids. I had, there's 11 kids in my family, and every decision that they made, I think they made in the interest of us.
Well, today, if they're part of the party of 40 that's here, we should be very proud of what they did and what he is.
And I think anytime you're a part of a family of 11 kids, you grow up having to be able to get around.
Rivers at the deep back. Mitchell back to throw it. Gets it to Moore. Herman Moore gets close to first down yardage. Walt Harris made the stop.
Yeah, we're talking about Ron Roget here, and you just see how, he's so big and so strong, and he has good feet. I mean, his feet are in good position, and he just has good arm extension. He gets his hands out there and gets his guy stopped initially and then just rides him and passes him off right beyond the quarterback.
Word on Porche, Robert Porche of the Lions, is that he has a sprained ankle, and his return is questionable. It's his left ankle.
You know, I was saying, I was standing there behind Juan Roget yesterday, and he was going in, and he's standing on the sideline, and he's getting ready to go in and work with the offense. He said, "I got to go get my swerve on." I've been around linemen all my life. been around tackles all my life. I coached a little bit, but I've never heard a guy run in and say, I got to go get my swerve on.
My swerve?
I got to go get my swerve on. You know what that means?
No.
I mean, I got to go get my stuff done. I got to, you know, start getting my stuff out there, my moves and stuff. I got to start getting my package together. That's your swerve.
It's a big package.
Well, I mean, that's the thing. I mean, you know, like after the game, we'll go and we'll get our swerve on with the turkey.
That's the end of the third quarter with the score. Detroit 34. Chicago 20. This Fox NFL special will continue after these messages and a word from your local Fox station. Ah, thank you. Our director, Sandy Grossman. To his right, Bob Stenner. And from them, happy Thanksgiving.
I think they said that, didn't they?
Yes.
Or did I just hear that in my headset? I heard Bob Stenner say, happy Thanksgiving, everyone.
Tommy Vardell gets the carry.
Yeah, this is the thing that you love to see. We talked about this last week in Green Bay, too, is more families at games, you know, more kids. You don't hear as much anymore. That I remember the first games I went to, my dad took me. But, you know, you do see a lot of young people in this crowd, and I'm glad to see that. I think the NFL needs that.
Thanksgiving Day. Dad can take them. Mitchell to Sanders. Barry Sanders.
Did Herman Moore get a block there? Anytime you get a long run by a running back, a wide receiver is going to get a block. But Herman Moore is not only a wide receiver, but Barry Sanders also set him up. We're going to see Barry Sanders here from an off-eye formation. Take the ball here on a lead. Bounce out. Herman Moore is blocking right there. Now watch Herman Moore come and get another one. He got the initial one. Barry Sanders sets him up, and Herman Moore just drives this guy right into the ground.
Tommy Vardell got a key block to spring the whole thing. 34-20. The Lions lead, and here's Sanders again. Sanders will score his third of the day. He is absolutely amazing. Keeps getting better. That's hard to imagine.
The Barry Sanders show. See, here he is back here. We talk about that. Here's your fullback lead right here. And it's going to be a draw play. They try and get the line to come up on a draw, but he just makes guys miss. I mean, he gets them, and he gets them to stop their feet, and he doesn't stop his feet. I mean, there's a lot of keys to Barry Sanders, but one of the keys is he makes you stop your feet, and his feet don't stop.
Watch that skip right there.
Yeah, and watch him. You see how he just gets guys to plant? Every guy in the National Football League, the thing they worry about, Barry Sanders and Mark Mann, everyone's going after him. And the thing they worry about is they don't want to be in any of his commercials. And he's putting a whole bunch of them in his commercials today.
What a performance.
This Fox NFL special is brought to you by Southwest Airlines, proud sponsor of the NFL and official airline of the Super Bowl. By Chevrolet Trucks, the most dependable, longest-lasting trucks on the road. By Dr. Pepper and your local Dr. Pepper bottler. Dr. Pepper, this is the taste. And by Miller Lite, now official beer sponsor of the NFL.
Barry Sanders, 19 carries, 167 yards, 3 touchdowns. Hansen for the extra point. 41-20 in favor of Detroit. Some of them were pretty close.
Yeah, how come that one kid always had the last word?
I don't know. Because he always had the best answer.
I like some of those other sounds better than his. I mean, the other one had good sounds. His was words.
Kickoff sails down to Tyrone Hughes. To the 20. And for McDonald's game break, send you back to James Brown at the Fox Television Center in Hollywood.
Pat, coming up on Fox NFL Sunday, Pam Oliver checks in with Andre Rison, an outstanding receiver having an outstanding season. And Mother Barber, who does she root for when Tiki and Rondé, identical twins, face each other for the first time? And the secret life of an NFL cheerleader. Some of director Sandy Grossman's best shots coming up. Fox NFL Sunday. Pat, I will diplomatically hand it back off to you.
Sandy Grossman has not discussed those shots with us. 41-20. Detroit leads the Bears. Raymond Harris. Stopped by Stephen Boyd.
Yeah, we were talking about the middle of that Detroit defense and the job that they've been doing. It's the same thing that Green Bay had, you know, with Gilbert Brown. When he was in there, if you can't get movement inside, then you're not going to get any running game going. And number 94 there, Luther Ellis, has had a lot to say about any running game that the Bears are going to get going.
He's had a big day. Side incomplete, intended for Chris Penn. This game's presented by authority of the National Football League, is intended for the private use of our audience. Any rebroadcast or other use of this telecast without the express written consent of the Detroit Lions and the NFL is prohibited.
Yeah, I was talking about Luther Ellison. One of the things that impressed me yesterday, I was in the Detroit locker room and there was a sign up there and said, anyone that doesn't have a place to go for Thanksgiving dinner can come to Luther's house. And then they told him just sign up and call Luther. So he invited the whole Detroit Lion team over to his house after the game. Now, that's pretty good.
But you had to let him know by Wednesday, according to the sign. Kramer. Chase. And that's a legitimate request.
Yeah, because he has to know how much stuff to get. I mean, you don't want, because the guys that are going to come are going to be big old eaters. I mean, you don't get too many guys in this league that aren't big old eaters.
Hasn't been a good half, second half.
Well, the Bears haven't had a first down in the second half.
God bless Luther, the sack man, the food man. Another straight ahead, pretty good return. 12:23 left to play. Detroit 41, the Bears 20. Again, a happy Thanksgiving. Look what we got a fan back there, but we got a turducken, right?
Yeah. This is a turducken right here, where we got, you know what a turducken is? A turducken, this thing here is a deboned duck stuffed in a deboned chicken stuffed in a deboned turkey. With stuffing, now you're talking. And that has eight legs.
The leg's got to have a bone, doesn't it? It can't be deboned if it's got legs.
No, then we put the legs on it, too. See, and you just kind of cut this right down the middle, and then you cut sideways, and you get a little turkey and a little chicken and a little duck. Now, that's there. That's turducken. Then over there, we have the turkey. See, now here's the turkey. We got one leg, two legs, three legs, four legs, five legs, six legs. So six of these legs or one of these legs or two of these six legs are going to be given to someone. I mean, whoever you want to give them to.
What do you want to do with those grapes?
No, the grapes are gone. And then I'm going to eat the turducken with anyone who wants to go on the way to Kansas City.
Metzelaars makes the catch. Back up. Tight end Roquet is leaving.
Yeah, Juan Roquet injured his knee on that last touchdown of the Lions. You see his injured left knee there. He was a rookie that we talked about that had played so well. And then he got cut. He just got hit right on the knee.
And that tractor's got a full load with Juan Roquet.
Yeah, it had to go into another gear as it went up the hill.
First and 10, Lions at the Bear 38. Mitchell. Wide open is David Sloan. Sloan. Carter. officials say that Sloan was down.
Yeah, it was good to see old Metzlars catch a pass there. And a 16-year veteran out of Wabash College. He brings his kids to practice, and his kids are like teenagers now. A real old veteran. I mean, that's an old veteran who's been around, played for a long time. I asked him the other day, how much longer he was going to play, and he says, how many more games we have left this year?
This is Rivers. He's into the end zone. Well, that's a play that's been good to the Lions today.
Now, the offensive line of the Lions is worn down, and Barry Sanders has really worn him down, and now it's pretty easy pickings for the running game in the Detroit Lions.
10:34 left to play.
And Rivers just runs that same play. It's a lead. They get in the I formation and lead. You just get that fullback lead in there, and then you pick a hole. I mean, you can follow your lead. You can bounce off your lead. You can cut it all the way back. And that's been a play that's been great all day for the Lions. Of course, Barry Sanders would make any play great all day for the Lions.
This would make it 48-20. A Lion lead over the Bears. Keep their playoff hopes alive. After today, they'll be 7-6. 48-20. Hope your Thanksgiving day has been enjoyable.
There's a group
this
right
group?
There.
Yeah.
Yeah, they're all working. They got a front load, the back load, old Fran Morrison in there, old junkyard behind them. Can't beat that group.
Flag on the play on the return. Tyrone Hughes.
Yeah, I want to see that group again that we just showed up to. Can you believe that? That group gets things up, that picture we just have. I don't know, what did we do, lose it? Did it go into the millennium or something?
Another look?
Yeah. Just to look, this is really where it starts. I mean, here's old Charles McDonald right here. But what happens is this here is the effing Fox. I mean, this is where it all starts. I mean, you got your McDonald's, your Schwabies, your Fran Morrison's, you got your junkyards. Junkyard doesn't even get a seat. Margaret and Ron McGuggins, old stretch up there, standing up, everyone trying to get into the picture. Bob there, he's looking on. But that's the effing Fox. If it weren't for those people, I don't think we'd ever get on the air, huh?
What about the other two letters, the Ox and Fox?
Well, then Ox is some other guy.
Yeah.
No one feels slighted. So how come you didn't say I was an F? Because you're nowhere next.
Today's game is being produced, by the way, by Bob Stinner and directed by Sandy Grossman. The associate director is Mike Roig, the broadcast associates. You were just mentioning Fran Morrison, Charles McDonald. Technical producer is Bob Muller. Stage manager is Rich Nelson. Studio produced by Scott Ackerson, directed by Bob Levy. Senior producer is Bill Brown. Executive producers of Fox Sports are Ed Gorin and David Hill. New quarterback, and in the booth with us, of course,
on the defense, number 24,
Wayne Fiddleman.
First down.
And Rick Odioso.
Yesterday, Dave Wannstedt had said that he wanted to get Steve Stenstrom, his backup quarterback, into the game. And he even thought about doing it in the second quarter, but things were going so well for the Bears at that time, there's no way that he could bring his backup. He said, but somewhere this year, I got to find out about Stenstrom.
Find out if he's going to be just another third guy or if he's a guy who can come in and lead the team.
Well, he's going to be a free agent, and Eric Kramer is going to be a free agent. So you have to know, do you do this? Is he a starter or is he a backup, or do we even bring him back? And what's going to happen to Eric Kramer?
Here's our group.
Where's Rich Nelson? Is he in there? He's back in here. Here's Rich Nelson back in here. So this is how you do it. You just draw. Here's Rick and here's... Here's Wayne, and there's you. There's you.
And you. Henry? Darnell Autry knocked out of bounds.
Boy, there's still some good hitting going on down there.
Sox knocked his socks down, knocked the ball out of his hand.
Yeah, we had...
Look, that's what Wayne was looking at. You saw him.
Yeah.
A moment ago.
Yeah, you get your binoculars, and that's what your shot looks like. I think if you're going to look at Steve Stenstrom, I think he has to throw the ball. I mean, I don't think that you can just come in there and even though the game may be out of hand and time is against you, but if you really want to see him, I think you got to let him play a little. Even though it's kind of tough when you're, you know, down by 28 points, say, hey, Steve, go on in there and get us 28 quickly.
Well, here comes the throwing down. Autry's behind Stenstrom. Well, Cole will be another touchdown. Tracy Scroggins picked it off in the air, and the Lions go into the 50s. Robert Bailey.
Bailey is going to come from the outside, and he is going to hit right here. Just as Stenstrom turns, Bailey hits him. Hits him square. The ball goes straight up in the air, and there's Robert Porche. Look at Bailey, even as a dance. He says this. You know, we talk about how Barry Sanders scores all kinds of touchdowns and breaks all kinds of records and one of the all-time great, and he does nothing when he does anything. And then you get Bailey, he gets a sack and the ball up in the air. He even has a dance.
The extra point is good. That's the second career touchdown for Scroggins. 55-28, 58 left.
Yep.
The old turkey's made its way to the sideline.
Yeah, we had it in the bus when we started today. And then we brought it in the booth with us.
Still got the garnish.
And now it's down in the sideline. Yeah, I guess they didn't get my word. Willie Yarbrough on the left, Joe Mitchell on the right. This turkey leg award has come a long way. Remember when we first did it, we didn't even have our own table. Now we have a table for it.
Watch out, you
better watch out.
Willie Yarbrough.
Someone better stand around. Someone may spit on it.
He had a yearning look. Whoa. Look. There's Willie.
That's where we come a long way. We have security now.
Yeah.
The security
camera. Larger.
Keep an eye. Keep an eye on that turkey with six legs.
Three. Garnish is gone from this side, but it's still on the other side.
Yeah, look at these grapes here. What the heck are those doing? Told me to get rid of those. But see, it has security. The turkey has security, but I'd watch those people up above it, wouldn't you?
Yeah, I think so. Hughes in the end zone. 55-20. The Lions over the Bears.
And this has to be tough for Dave Wannstedt. I think this whole year has been tough for Dave and his coaching staff. You know, they've tried everything that they could think of, and nothing has worked. They've only won two games, and you know, you have a lot of decisions at the end of the season, and you can't really stay with the same program because the program that you have now has proven that it doesn't work.
Well, they beat a good team last week. They beat Tampa Bay last week.
Yeah, and then, you know, they had a good first half here today, but you can just, I mean, they just don't have enough speed on offense, and they just don't have enough players. I mean, they don't have a dominant player in the front seven.
Pretty hard to win in this league.
Look at this. Most points scored in a regular season game, the Detroit Lions. They know how to play on Thanksgiving Day. Remember last time we had them here on Thanksgiving Day? Brett Perryman had over 100 yards. Herman Moore had over 100 yards. Johnny Morton had over 100 yards. Barry Sanders had over 100 yards. Scott Mitchell threw for over 400.
The backup quarterback, Steve Stenstrom. There's Bob Seiderman, the spider.
The audio guy, and they... Those were some good field sounds they just gave us on that last play.
Look at this. Rich Nelson.
Yeah, Fats is there with him.
He's got the orange, Rich.
What are they doing?
Rich looked like he hadn't eaten in some time.
That was a tape shot. I just looked around there and thought I'd see him, and they weren't even together.
Flags come flying as...
Old Mark Spindler was the first guy. He started again. He kind of likes to get those early jumps.
Encroachment on the defense, number 92. 5-yard penalty, first down.
Mark Spindler, 55 points, the most points the Bears have ever allowed. Previous was 53. 55 points, the most points ever for the Lions in a regular season game. They scored 59 in a championship game against the Browns in 1957.
And I think when you have a year like the Chicago Bears are having won two games, I think those kinds of things are going to happen to you.
Pass incomplete, intended for Ricky Prohl, who got off to such a sensational start. Barry Sanders, you think he's through for the day?
I think when you start taking your clothes off, you're through. You can't play in this league without socks. I mean, that's one thing, the uniform code, you have to have the socks on. And Barry is going someplace. You'd have to have the special scissors to take off the tape job. But he's going someplace in a hurry. He's not going to spend a heck of a lot of time around here.
Feed those 40 that he had as guests.
I know it, but I mean, you know, you can't say who's going to get a turkey leg award and not say Barry Sanders. So I hope he doesn't leave before we give him a turkey leg.
Stenstrom's pass caught by Penn. And he could have a Bear first down. Well, you can take the tape off and put your shoes and socks back on for a turkey leg award, can't you?
Yeah, but you're not going to play when you take the tape off. See, now he doesn't have to worry when he goes inside about taking his tape off.
Just bury the whole bird, John.
You know, I mean, that's probably right. And that guy had to make that up last night or sometime before the game. And, you know, I mean, we could have done that.
Yeah.
Not even worried about it.
Pass is caught by Ricky Prohl.
You know, getting back to the Bears and the decisions that they have to make, you know, is what are they going to do with Dave Wannstedt? I think Dave Wannstedt is a heck of a coach.
And well, he has a contract.
Are they going to honor the contract or are they going to let him go? I think they keep him. I mean, I think that the problem with the Bears, to me, is not Dave Wannstedt. I think he's a good coach. What do they do with Eric Kramer? Do they bring him back? What do they do with Rick Meyer? They made the big trade for and he's not even active.
He was supposed to be the number one guy. The ball came loose and the Lions get it back.
So this is a Lions day today.
Mike Wells made the recovery. Bobby Ross gave us those five goals that you mentioned earlier. I'd say they did a pretty good job.
Well, the turnover ratio, he won that. The third down conversion, he won that. Starting field position, Glenn Milburn, that was great. His red zone offense, 24 points. And then the only thing is the penalties. He has two more than the Bears. But when you get those other four as dominantly as you did.
Two less yards than penalties than the Bears.
Yeah, so if it is yardage, then he won all five.
Barry Minter made the stop.
Look at what Barry Sanders did today.
We'll look at it in a second. It's Rivers in his place. Look at his carries and performance today. The last 11 carries, 140 yards. Those are games, I beg your pardon. Remember, he got off to a very slow start?
Well, in the first couple of games, he didn't do anything, and that was what Bobby Ross says, that, you know, that that we weren't patient. I mean, look and say we didn't give Barry Sanders the ball enough, and now he has someone checking all the time. How many carries does Barry have? Because he never wants one of those games where he comes out after and then someone says Barry Sanders only handled the ball 10 times. He said he wants him to handle the ball 25 times, and he's never going to get away from him, and he's always going to be patient with him. And you can see that after, and that was after the second game, and then after that, then boom. I mean, just things went, and Barry Sanders became Barry Sanders again. But it took Bobby Ross and his staff a couple of games to adjust.
Third and one, 4:20 left to play. Rivers.
Well, when you get them softened up, anyone can run. And that's what Ron Rivers is doing now. In fact, he had his touchdown. That touchdown that he scored last time they had the ball was his first touchdown. You just see now, and sometimes you just play with a guy like Barry Sanders and you're running the same plays and you're over there on the sideline and you're watching him and the things that he's doing, and you know that you can make guys miss if you keep your feet going.
They're even close to being the same size.
And I will say this, that the Bears tackling now is not very good. They have lost their fundamentals.
I think they've lost a little.
They've lost
desire to play.
They've lost everything. Yeah, they're whipped.
Schlesinger. So Detroit will improve their record to 7-6. As you see, the three teams in front of them. Green Bay, Minnesota, and Tampa Bay. The remaining games the Lions have are not easy. Miami, Minnesota, and the New York Jets. Of course, they'll get a 10-day period now to rest.
That's a big thing with playing on Thanksgiving. The bad news is you have a short time to get ready. The good news is if you win the game, then you get 10 days off, 10 days between games.
Mm-hmm. And the Hurts, people like Roquet, have an extra couple of 3 days to heal. This is Schlesinger inside the 15, or about to the 15, I should say. Yeah, a lot of arguments about whether it's an advantage or disadvantage to play on Thanksgiving Day, both in Dallas and here. The teams that get it every year become accustomed to it, and it becomes something they look forward to a little bit. The teams that have to travel to come here don't like it so much.
I think it's an advantage. I think, you know, it's an advantage if you have it and you're playing every year. You're doing it every year because you not only, as you said, the advantage to know how to do it, but it's also a home game. So you're home, you know how to do it, and the other guy has to travel and doesn't know how to do it.
2 minutes left. The Lions will win three consecutive games for the first time since last year. Again, a happy Thanksgiving. Joe Abenda just pushes buttons and things happen. Barry Sanders just gets the ball and things happen. 2 minutes left. Schlesinger. Barry Sanders, his career on Thanksgiving Day, 9 games, 8 touchdowns, 4 100-yard-plus games. Yards per carry average 4.7. Today, I think, is his best, without question, his best Thanksgiving Day ever. Not his best in total yards, but another 100-yard-plus. Break the record. And that's all he'll do from here on out is break records.
Yeah, and you were right. Today is his best Thanksgiving Day ever. It's an honor to be here today.
Yeah, watch that. Schlesinger again, the special teams ace.
He's also a demolition derby ace. Remember when he was in high school, his dad gave him a car to enter a demolition derby. He's from Nebraska, and he entered a demolition derby, and he loved it. And I think those things kind of go hand in hand. Blocking fullback, special teams guy, demolition derby.
I had a car that I demolished, but it wasn't in a derby.
Would you have won a prize if it had been in a derby?
No. I just wrecked it.
But Schlesinger looks like a demolition derby guy from Nebraska. You know, I go through Nebraska a lot on the bus. You know, and Schlesinger just looks like he's from Nebraska. Yeah. You know, I mean, you go and you stop in Nebraska, eat or something, you see a lot of Schlesingers there.
A lot of Tom Rathmans. Just over a minute as Darnell Autry gets the carry. But don't leave us, because we got to give out those turkey legs, don't forget. Yeah. Become a very cherished award.
Well, it's something. There they are. We have six of them to give away, and now we have security. I can't believe that. I can't believe that we've gotten that big with the turkey leg.
You going to give away all six?
Yeah, I was in a hotel, and the Rolling Stones were there, and they didn't have as much security as that turkey has, I swear to you.
Darnell Autry again. Yeah. Get a crown for they still got the garnish. The grapes are still there. I want some of those grapes. That's
look at that. Keep people taking pictures of it and everything. And there's Dave Wannstedt. A terrible day for him. A great day for Barry Sanders and the Detroit Lions, Bobby Ross. Eric Kramer, old teammates, Kevin Glover.
This play of the game is brought to you by Energizer, a very unique look at the legs of Barry Sanders.
You know, we always look at the shoulder and the eyes and the hands, and you wonder how all those things get there, and that's how they all get there.
The plays of the game, the legs of the game. Well, maybe the turkey legs of the game. And the turkey is ready yet. It is ready on the sideline as Detroit destroys Chicago 55-20. So stick with us for the Turkey Leg Award. Back at the Silverdome, Detroit 55, Chicago 20. And the winners of the Turkey Leg have enjoyed they're enjoying the ceremonies on the sidelines already. So Barry Sanders on your right. Johnny Morton in the middle. Luther Ellis, defensive tackle, who had such an outstanding day. And John Madden, you're the sort of the guru of the turkey, so go ahead.
Well, first of all, congratulations to everyone. And Barry, what a special day for you. I mean, did you have any feeling that this was going to happen today?
Well, no, I had no idea. The last couple of weeks, we played very well offensively and really as a team. And so we're developing a lot of confidence. And Coach, we've learned a lot from our six losses, and we showed that today.
I'll tell you, you're sure a lot of fun to watch. Hey, Johnny, why don't you just take over and give him a turkey leg? Start giving him out down there.
Well, I'm gonna give one leg to the best running back in the history of the NFL, and that's Barry. He's very humble, but hey, he deserves it.
You won't get any arguments about that.
Thanks a lot. Oh, yeah. I guess as a running back, you can never have enough legs. So.
All right, and one of the primetime defensive linemen on our team, Big Luther Ellis.
And then Johnny, you got to take one for yourself.
Okay.
J-Mo.
I love these.
J-Mo.
Favorite turkey. My favorite.
Let's have a look at some of the highlights, and there were many, believe me, of today. The Barry Sanders runs today. Averaged 8.8 yards a carry.
You guys talk about Johnny.
Well, it's kind of hard to explain Barry. He's an original. And, of course, you see guys flying around. Barry
he's
makes
special.
About five guys miss per play. He's the best in the business.
John, I'm just glad he's on my side.
That's yes. All.
Yeah, how'd you like that? Yeah, Luther, how'd you like to have to tackle him?
No, I wouldn't care to. I don't think I could. But I'm just glad Barry's on our side. He is the greatest. I'm just thankful that he's on our team.
You
Very
guys
thankful.
Sure dominated there on defense, you know, especially in the second half. I don't think the Bears had a first down in the second half.
Well, you know, we just felt we gave up those two big plays, a couple touchdowns that we shouldn't have, and we wanted to redeem ourselves. So Coach just really challenged us at halftime, say, can you guys play better than that? I mean, that's all we were trying to do is come out and play hard.
Well, you sure did play better than that. Johnny, how about the rest of the year? How do you guys look at the rest of the season?
Well, we know we have to win out for a chance at the playoffs, and with these two guys next to me and the rest of the Lions, it's going to be hard to stop us. We're going to focus, and try to take it all the way.
How about the 10 days rest now? Is that an advantage for you guys?
Thank you, Lord.
Yeah, I think we need it, because after today was a big war. It's a physical game. I think we need the rest. It's almost like a bye week. I'm sure Luther, Barry needs it. I need it for sure, and it's going to be a fun few days off.
Let me just circle you here. I mean, to have a Barry Sanders, Johnny Morton, Luther Ellis to get the Turkey Leg Award, I'll tell you, up here in the booth, we're very, very proud to have you as a recipient.
Thank you
for a great game. Congratulations.
It's been an honor. Thank you. Appreciate it. I want to say hi to everybody.
Take that bird in for your teammates. Circle around it.
I will share it.
Thanks, guys.
Hey, L.A.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
55-20. Let's go now to James Brown.
All right, Pat, thank you very much. I actually thought that Johnny Morton was throwing it to us when he said, hello, L.A., as we welcome you to the NASDAQ postgame report. Full house here with Ronnie, Howie, Terry, yours truly, J.B. One guy who wasn't in that picture, Scott Mitchell, had an outstanding game as well, contributing to that big win.
After the early start in the first quarter, we were all sitting here talking, when are they going to run Barry? When are they going to run Barry? And finally, you know, they did get to run Barry, but Scott played exceptionally well. I do one point to make about Barry Sanders is this. If he needs 512 yards to pass Eric Dickerson for the all-time NFL rushing lead of 2,105 yards, that adds up to 170 yards a game over the next three games.
Yeah, a remarkable guy, and I think this coaching staff deserves a lot of credit. Bobby Ross stuck with his game plan. They struggled early. I think it took a while for this coaching staff to understand quite how to utilize the talent that they have. Morton had an outstanding game. Herman Moore, an outstanding receiver. This is an offense that not too long ago was one of the more high-powered offenses in the NFL. You look at Luther Ellis. Luther Ellis has turned into one of the more dominant defensive tackles in football, and I don't think it really happened until they moved Luther from defensive end to defensive tackle. They tried to make him a defensive end at first, and he's really not. It's like putting a ribbon on a pig. He needs to be a defensive tackle and plays that position outstanding and had an outstanding day today.
You know what's interesting is that we're sitting here watching Barry Sanders and looking at him as a football player. I'm thinking to myself, I've never walked off the football field looking like that. I mean, he looks like he hasn't had anything happen to him today, and yet this guy rushes for so many yards today. To me, you got to say that Barry Sanders, you deserve a symbol for your name.
The great ones make things look easy.
They really
Barry
do.
Sanders
certainly, his physical conditioning helped indeed. And just to think that the Bears had a 17-3 lead early in the game, give up 52 points, most ever allowed by the Bears. 55 points, that's right. Yeah. So the Lions went on a 52-3 run, and in fact, to do that. Right. Hey, in terms of the second game, Tennessee and Dallas, there's a report out of Dallas that Troy Aikman right now has back spasms. Questionable as to whether or not he will start. It will be a game-time decision. We talked about the Oilers being a dangerous squad. Can Dallas win without Troy Aikman at the helm?
Yeah, I think they can. Wade Wilson is very capable at the quarterback spot. I think that he can get the job done, but then that goes to Emmitt Smith. Can Emmitt Smith run the football, and can they move down the field and score in the red zone?
Yeah, I think the big thing for Dallas right now is regardless who's a quarterback, and I think it will be difficult for Wade Wilson to be successful. Houston has Tennessee.
That's $5 in the kitty.
My wife only let me out with three, and I got to get out of the hotel with tips, so give me a break.
You tip now.
It's Thanksgiving.
It's going to be difficult. They've got those corners, and they need to take advantage of those corners. It's going to be difficult with Wade Wilson doing that. You know, you've got all kinds of things. You got a rookie center in there. You've got a new quarterback in taking the snap count with the offensive lineman. Emmitt Smith needs to run the ball. Keep that offense off the field with Eddie George. Remarkable offensive line, as John Madden pointed out, and Woodson is a gigantic loss. I mean, this guy has toughed it out. He's been banged up for a number of weeks, taking shots every week, and you had to wonder, it would just be a certain amount of time before he would succumb and take a game off. If he played today, I don't think he would have been able to play the
running. A contrast in great running backs, Eddie George, 6'3", about 225, a straight-up runner. Yeah, you know, 230, 240. Yeah. Just a big, powerful, young running back that Tennessee has back there. McNair. They will create a lot of problems. Right. I agree with you. I do not think Dallas can win this football game unless Troy, who had that back operation, what, three or four years ago, now the spasms are starting to pop up. They need Troy Aikman in there.
As far as the Lions are concerned, you've been doing this all day. They had a two-thumbs-up day, right? Let me see that.
Two thumbs up.
Two thumbs up, yeah. His brother Craig has got him going. All right, folks, a reminder to tune in on
Happy
Sunday.
Thanksgiving,
Fox NFL Sunday coming your way. Early games highlighted by San Francisco at Arrowhead Stadium. Other games, New Orleans and Carolina, Rams at Washington. Late games highlighted by the Tampa Bay Buccaneers taking on the Giants. For Ronnie, Howie, Terry, I'm James Brown. Happy Thanksgiving, and we will see you on Sunday.
You're amazing, James.
come on. It's